Good morning and welcome to the third meeting of the committee in 2015. Everyone present is asked to switch off all mobile phones and other electronic equipment as they affect the broadcasting system. Some committee members will refer to tablets during the course of the meeting. That's because we provide papers in digital format. If we can move to agenda item one today, which is the consideration of a negative SSI. That's the Freedom of Information Scotland Act 2002, Scottish Public Authorities Amendment Order 2014, SSI 2014/354. Members have a cover note from the clerk explaining the instrument. As you will note, the Delegated Powers and Law Reform Committee did not have any comments to make on this instrument. Do members have any comments? Are we agreed not to make any recommendations to the Parliament on this instrument? Thank you very much. Agenda item two is our sixth oral evidence session on the Air Weapons and Licensing Scotland Bill. Today, we're taking evidence from witnesses in the provisions relating to taxi and private car hire. We begin this morning with evidence from Dr. James Cooper of Edinburgh and Napier University and the University of Missouri in the USA. We will then hear from a panel of witnesses from the taxi and private car hire trade, and then from licensing authorities and hire car service users. Before we start, can I point out that witnesses don't need to press the buttons on the consoles. The microphones will be operated by the sound engineer. Can I welcome Dr. James Cooper to the meeting? And do you have any opening remarks that you'd like to make, Dr. Cooper?
Well, thank you ever so much, Chair, for inviting me to give evidence. I have prepared a short presentation for you and would be delighted to take questions to the extent that I'm able to answer them.
Please go ahead.
Okay. Well, good morning, ladies and gentlemen. Thank you ever so much for inviting me. My presentation will address issues specific to taxi licensing, which in my definition will include hackney carriages, private hire cars, and other vehicle types offering a comparable service, which have been titled in some places as transportation network companies, and include examples of this being Uber, UberX, Lyft, and various others who provide services in a taxi-like way. If I do mention specific trade names and company names, this is specifically to give you an example of a service type. It is not intended to single out any particular company in my commentary. And I want to commend the Parliament and the Government in the desire and effort to develop taxi and private hire car legislation. This is both appropriate and commendable to provide a legislative framework that facilitates and protects in the public interest. And it is my belief that this needs to be aware of the current market, current change in the market, and future activities that may impact upon the effectiveness and implementation of the legislation. And it is my contention that the bill as stands fails currently to address the needs of a transformed market, that which is likely to emerge in the very near future. And I also need to highlight the view that in framing legislation, it is quite easy to suffer from a belief that the legislative framework itself is sufficient to ensure appropriate supply. Evidence from locations where the market has been transformed do not uphold this, that many of the new entrants sit between legislative instruments, and it is important that that point is made clear, the best that I can, that the market in its transformed state will be very different to the market that we see now. So I suppose the most important question is, what is a transformed market? And I would highlight this as being the opposite of the legacy market, the one that we know and has operated successfully for a significant amount of time, with legislation dating back to 1847 and even prior to that still being in force in some places in the United Kingdom. The transformed market will include new technology operators, predominantly those associated with smartphone applications, otherwise known as apps, and these exist in a number of generations and have been present in the taxi and taxi-like industries for about 5 years. Having said that, we are currently even in six generations of apps, which must suggest a very rapid evolution within that market of one revolution per 8 months or thereabouts, as opposed to one revolution in legislation for taxis in every 80 years or so. This difference is a significant one. The transformed market will also include quasi-taxis, vehicles that operate within the taxi market and operate a taxi-like service, often indistinguishable to those choosing to use them. And it is these vehicle types that have been named transportation network companies in the United States of America, often abbreviated to TNCs. New services will spread across licensing categories, offering services from a variety of traditional licensing distinctions, and many which sit currently out with current legislation. And this transformed market will facilitate service provision by private individuals offering trips in their own private cars under a effectively private contract. This, however, does not fit readily into the distinction of ride sharing, a term that has been applied in some locations. In my definition, ride sharing is a positive public contribution in offering a ride for a part of a trip that would exist in any case, whereas TNCs and quasi-taxis provide ride sharing on a commercial basis for profit. And it is also worth noting that the transformed market, and specifically the apps that facilitate transportation, will often obscure the category of vehicle that you are engaging, and thus its legality or otherwise from the user. It is my belief that to frame legislation currently is appropriate, but needs to be done in a sustainable manner. That the government and parliament need be aware of the transformed market in developing its legislation and legislate to an extent that supports policy in the new market dynamic. I'm going to touch on taxi and private hire car distinctions, and I highlight that hackney carriage and private hire car services are distinct only in the legacy market. They are consistent only in their legislative differences. Apps effectively provide electronic hail to quasi-taxis, removing one of the few distinctions of the hackney carriage. Number constraint, which is a part of some hackney carriage markets, may become ineffective under its current testing if the regulation that allows for it is unenforceable. It may also be that number constraint become irrelevant if its market impact is lost. And I will highlight that the measurements applied to number constraint, commonly known as a measure of significant unmet demand, or SUD, will become impossible in its current form in a transformed market. That doesn't exclude the possibility of testing and measurement, but requires change. This will have an impact on all other areas of regulatory control, to wit, quality control and economic constraint, fares and leases, as these three elements of quantity, quality and economic controls are completely interlinked and cannot be divorced from each other. I will touch briefly, if I may, on taxi numbers and quantity constraints.
If, Dr. Cooper, because we do have quite a lot of questions to get through as well, please.
I will highlight that the The concept of quantity restraint has been based on a view of market failure and a lack of equilibrium. These concerns do change when the market is transformed. I would also underline that the concept that being proposed for the licensing and regulation of private hire car numbers appears to me to be unenforceable in a transformed market and is not measurable for quasi-taxis. I would also note that the cost for studies indicated appears to me to be completely incorrect. I will touch very briefly on two further points. Market transformation. And I will highlight that there has been and continues to be a clear demand for app-based booking. And this has not been and has not been predicted in any SUD study, to my knowledge, to this point. The transformed market has grown, but also impacts on traditional hackney carriage use between 20 and 40%. That is a 20 to 40% loss in taxi use. And there is evidence that cities and governments may find it easier to recast legislation than seek to enforce it. My final point relates to accessibility. To date, no TNC fleet vehicle is accessible at all, using the term related to wheelchair accessible vehicles, which I believe is well defined. This is because the companies providing these services primarily rely on private individuals to supply vehicles. This is an UberX type of service, which negates any desire for equality in access at the same price. And I will, if I may, finally point out on one area which relates to market manipulation. And this licensing concept in this licensing review discusses cost neutrality to councils in that the cost of any tests applied are covered through the fees of the private hire and taxi industries. A TNC does not need to win any legal challenge. It simply needs to push the price to the taxi industry beyond a tipping point, at which point taxi supply becomes an uneconomic and non-commercial venture. I'll pause at that point.
Thank you very much, Dr. Cooper. You have highlighted some areas which the committee has already asked the government for clarification on. In terms of the growth of mobile phone apps and Uber, we posed some questions to government and have had a response back from civil servants which states, whilst the taxi and private hire car provisions in the bill do not specifically address technological developments, the Civic Government Scotland Act 1982 already provides considerable scope for secondary legislation to address such issues, and we also have the ability to provide the clarification and best practice guidance for local authorities. Could you give us an indication of what you think of that response from government?
It appears to me that the technology has moved so very, very quickly that any response needs to be aware of its current and future development. It is true that the taxi industry has provided apps and app-based bookings. The relative effectiveness of those services pale in comparison to the TNC operations, and are restrained by the commercial operations within which they fit. In short, the technology is advancing at such a speed that it may not be possible to fully understand its impact prior to its application.
Uber this week have tried to be somewhat conciliatory in response to some of the criticisms that have been made, and obviously they're facing legal challenges in a number of countries at this moment in time. They've been accused of course, of flouting competition rules, and there are major concerns in places about lack of sufficient safety checks on drivers and their vehicles. How can we ensure that these companies in future, if and when they enter the Scottish market, cannot flout safety rules and regulations?
It is, Chair, a very difficult question to answer. As evidence suggests that most cities and governments have been powerless to control some of the excesses of some of the TNC companies. To my knowledge, the most common response is one of fining and placing citation upon Uber drivers. There is a difficulty in that the company providing the service does not in itself does not consider itself to be a transportation company at all, but rather a technology company, and therefore outside of the regulation of transport, which applies to the drivers that happen to use its service. Therefore, citations and fines are placed upon the drivers, and the most common response by Uber has been to pay the fine, as a cost of entering a market. The only really successful action against Uber has been by the Spanish government, which has been by the Spanish court, I apologise, which has been to remove telecommunications access to its app, effectively preventing anybody getting to Uber through their smartphone. This comes at a very high price, in that not everything that the technology allows is a bad idea. Perhaps its application is bad, perhaps its application is illegal, but the concept behind it may be harmed by the removal of the service. Very, very hard to accommodate Uber. Cities in the US that have done so by changing their laws, changing their chapters and codes in a way that is satisfactory, if you'll excuse the term, to the companies that have wanted the change. That has been effectively the only method by which the services become fully legal.
So in terms of those changes in laws, do you think that we have the flexibility with current legislation and the proposed draft bill to make those changes if necessary, if Uber or others decided to try and enter the Scottish market?
No, I'm afraid I don't. I believe the bill as it stands reflects the legacy market alone and will not be fit in terms of its following market.
So you would disagree with the statement that I read out earlier from the civil servant in response to our questioning?
I'm afraid I do.
Okay, and your reasoning for that?
I believe that there is a positive benefit accrued by Uber in being seen to be the wrong side of the law, that it gains notoriety amongst its user group, and it will benefit from that position. It's also my contention that the market that this will facilitate, the market that we're heading to, has inherent problems in itself that will require further addressing. We are heading towards a monopolistic provider based on app provision that in itself will require considerable review in the future. I fear that the concepts as set out in the bill do not, and the ability to control technological developments, do not foresee the extent to which the market will change.
I'm going to take in Mr. Riley in a minute, who wants a supplementary to that. But in terms of the monopoly of the application of the app, I this morning took a taxi to Parliament, I should say at my own expense, before anybody says that I'm abusing my position in terms of transportation. Sitting in the taxi, there's an advert for the app of that taxi company, which I could download to my phone. I can order that taxi on that app, and I can track the taxi and where it is on that app, or so the advert says. I haven't used it. So you're saying that Uber has a monopoly in terms of these applications, or is monopolistic. How can you say that when all of these other apps are being developed?
Okay, the contention, Chair, was that it may become monopolistic.
Okay.
If you've looked at any of the Edinburgh Hackney Carriage apps, I do recommend them. They are extremely good. And it's worth highlighting the fact that the benefits of this technology should not be underestimated. I mean, there are very, very good reasons for having apps of this nature. It is the nature of the market where Uber sits and others of the same type in terms of its market dominance and its market share. For the first time, we are dealing with a company that is not local but global. We are dealing with an app that is transferable without any penalty between location. It is an app with a great deal of power. And I would suggest that of the six generations, while the taxi companies have a very good product even now, they are still behind where the TNCs sit, primarily because the nature of their product is distinct to one form of transportation alone, whereas the TNC product crosses multiple distinctions in multiple vehicles at multiple prices. You will see, if you choose to look, you may slide between vehicles of different types on the Uber app and others without really being aware of the distinction of licensing and legality that that choice results in.
Alec Rowley, please.
Not reflect the transformed market, then I suppose the question is, what does it need to do to reflect that market? And is there examples of legislation in other countries that we can perhaps look at?
There are examples of legislation where in a transformed market, and I will point you to both the Washington DC Chapter 31 and the code in Houston, Texas, that exist post app development. A significant difficulty arises in the testing and assurance of driver safety, and the testing and assurance of vehicle safety, and various other issues around quality and age of vehicles. That will often be handled by external third parties against the will of the licensing authority and the traditional taxi industry, in that the taxi industry fits in a very, very distinct, this is how we do it, this is what's legally required, and the newcomer tends to be seen as not following the same rules at a significantly lower cost. It is a competitive issue as well as a legislative issue.
Okay.
Would it be fair to say that here in Scotland at this moment in time, we have not entered what you term as the transformed market?
That is a fair comment. It is my belief that Scotland is on the brink of entering the transformed market, and it will develop exceptionally quickly once it starts.
On the brink, would you have any idea? I know this is a very difficult question, but do you have any idea when the transformed market is likely to happen here?
It is my understanding that Uber Britannia has applied for licences in Glasgow and in Edinburgh currently. I believe that they will be granted, and that company will begin to operate a variety of services in Scotland, starting with those that fall under private hire car legislation, but rapidly expanding in other locations. Evidence suggests rapid expansion into other forms of Uber. Uber is not a single product. It is about seven products, both Manchester and London. London, for example, has five Uber products, including something which it calls Uber Taxi. The most contentious of which will be Uber X, which is the private individual providing transportation, and it is that product that has the most concerns to me in its legislative standing, and also the power to change the market to the greatest extent. If you ask for a time scale from launch to Uber X, is probably 6 months.
Okay, thank you. Cameron Buchanan, please.
Thank you very much indeed. Do you consider that the underlying reasons underpinning the need for the licensing of taxis and private hire cars is necessary, and you said in your submission that we should probably recast legislation. Does that mean we should abandon this for the moment because the technology is moving too fast? Have we only covered half the problem?
If we wait until the market is settled, we will be seeing five or six more generations. I mean, the problem here is that the technology will continue to change, and what we see now will be followed by innovations, which I feel may be around line planned ride sharing. No, as a simple answer, it is my view that there should be current legislation, but that current legislation should to provide sufficient power and regulatory authority to address changes that are currently foreseen.
Cameron?
Should we be... what do you see as the advantage between the two-tier system we've got at the moment with private hire and hackney carriages, as you call them? Is there any advantages?
Today, 2015, yes. Tomorrow, 2015.
No.
No.
So I thought, right. So, do you think then we should be recasting this or slightly changing, maybe taking it out of the bill, in order to reform it, or tighten it, if you like.
I would certainly agree it needs tightening. I don't have an alternative text for you. My apologies. The single tier, dual tier system question. It is a significant one, and it is one that, in effect, may become irrelevant, however many tiers you choose to have, if you have somebody who ignores the tiers altogether, which is where you're going. The dual tier system that we currently have serves a purpose and has served a purpose very well. And that purpose will remain. Reasons for that distinction will remain. It is then a need to go back and ask, well, why do you regulate in the first place? Well, what's the purpose of having regulation? In a purely commercial market, there's very limited control. But the taxi market has not operated in that way for hundreds of years, with good reason. I think the question is why? Why do we control, and what purpose, what potential benefit is there to maintaining that, and what potential disbenefit is there in the loss of that control?
Could I just ask?
On you go.
Thank you very much. Because technology, as you said, is moving so fast, should we, either if we don't take this bit out, should we therefore make it a bit looser so that it covers all aspects? That's what I was really meaning, I think.
I think it's
for the future.
I think it is appropriate to cover all aspects. I mean, I think it would be a loss of opportunity not to address the aspects that we foresee in transformed markets elsewhere. If we talk about one of the fundamentals of taxis being street hire, applying for hire, and operating in a restricted market in some locations, there is a question around the validity of tests applied to maintaining that market once the market has transformed. We see this as the significant unmet demand test that even in its move from, if it were to move as suggested from taxis alone to taxis and private hire cars, would require significant renovation to remain valid, and even further renovation in a fully transformed market with players that don't abide by it anyway.
Thank you.
John Lawson, please.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, Dr. Cooper. The issue here, and taking on board the transformed market that you're relating to, surely the issue in terms of legislation should be to make sure that all cars and all drivers are licensed. Would that not be a way of getting around Uber and UberX, is to turn around and say, if you are providing a service for profit, that you should be licensed, the car should be licensed, and the appropriate insurances should apply to the delivery of that service? Rather than just saying that we're moving towards a transformed market where anybody can use an app, hail a car, to come and pick them up, and that the individual is not aware whether or not that person is a licensed driver, whether the car's licensed, whether the car's fully equipped to actually deal with the passengers concerned, and more importantly, it is insured in the event that there may be an injury or other factors involved in the use of that car.
I think I need to preface the answer by saying it is essential, and there is no question in my mind that vehicles need to be insured and tested. Drivers need to be safe, insured, licensed, controlled in the public interest. And I have no hesitation in saying that that is the correct outcome of a licensing and regulatory regime. That is the role of government and its regulators. And I say that as a preface because I have observed multiple cities, and too many to count, where the belief was that regulation and laws were sufficient to that purpose. My city has laws that are sufficiently good, and why would anybody break them? Why would anybody attempt to twist them? And time after time, that has proven wrong, that there are determined companies with huge resource who seek to achieve reform or change that reduces and makes unenforceable the legislation of that city. And I will give you the example of Houston, Texas, as one with which I'm aware, that a year and a half ago, that was the view that our regulations were strong enough, and the regulations were effective and strong in an industry that chose to obey them, chose to follow them. The moment a player comes in with massive numbers of operators, 2,000, 3,000, 10,000, private individuals, that law becomes unenforceable simply through the mechanics of its enforcement regime. And if you were to see the same thing in Scotland, where Police Scotland were seeking to prosecute tens of thousands of drivers, and a company that would be prepared to cover fines applied to those drivers, I think it begins to paint a picture of a less enforceable regime. It's a perfect storm, if you like. It's one that you cannot solve while you have an entity that chooses to go a different route, which is why so many cities answer the problem by changing their laws to reflect the demands of the incoming player, much to the complaint of the existing players who have done nothing wrong, and actually much to their harm. When we have an incomer that takes up to 40% of the market, the traditional market will be different. It will be a poorer market. The quality of services will be poorer. One of the outcomes of regulation as it stands are very, very high quality taxis in this city and others in the country. And the impact will be a negative one on users of that service. I could talk about relative qualities of service, and I think in Scotland there is a large advantage to the traditional taxi trade in that it is better than its US counterparts, much better than some of its US counterparts, but that in itself may not be sufficient a distinction to maintain the market share it enjoys currently.
Dr. Cooper, you made reference to the enforcement regimes, the current enforcement regimes, and you've also made reference to the fines applied, and you gave examples that Uber have picked up some of the fines that have been imposed on drivers in other jurisdictions. The issue put to you is, are the fines sufficient? And is there a way under the, as you see it, under the present regime of international legislation, to find a way to actually find Uber itself? Because while you said that they claim to be a technology company, they are contracting drivers to deliver a service for them. Yes. Therefore, I don't see them as a technology company. I see them as a business which is using drivers. And therefore, are we tackling the correct individual by just finding the driver? Or should, as any legislation that is introduced, be able to target the company that is effectively undermining the existing legislation yeah. of a region or an area? Because that's what you're saying, that there are new entrants to the market. But effectively, what the image that you're giving me today is they are actually undermining and acting illegally under the current legislation that exists or potential future legislation.
Dr. Keeper?
I certainly agree with your stylization as to what they do. I'm not sure that they will agree with it. Mm-hmm. In my perception, they do no different a job than a traditional radio taxi circuit in Scotland presently. It is purely the way in which it is booked. They will make a very distinct difference. There has been some examples of the company, Uber Technologies, being prosecuted and indicted, and the most recent effectively is Spain, but a more relevant example may be that in Germany, where they were effectively found to be in breach of regulation, but let off on a technicality, if you like the terminology, forgive me for an American term, in that the wrong company was prosecuted. There are a number of forms of Ubers and others. I have to be clear, it is not simply one company. And beware that the prosecution goes to the right place, which I believe is Uber Technologies Amsterdam, but they may be incorrect in that assertion. The problem that I have seen in the United States is that the extent of fine that can be imposed in terms of its value is not harmful or punitive on the company, but can be very harmful and punitive on the driver. And that relates to the actual amount of fine or, in some instances, the removal of the vehicle. To the company, is a value which is huge and unbelievably so, it is nothing. And it could well be interpreted as a cost of market entry. To the driver, it is very significant. And were Uber not to pick it up, there would be a change in behaviour. Do I believe legislation can do it currently? I believe it is possible, but I think it is not easy. And I think the extent to which the enforcement regime would need to go after multiple individuals makes it very hard to enforce.
Thank you very much indeed.
In terms of the checks that we've talked about earlier, safety checks, checks on drivers and on vehicles, which Uber and their like don't have to comply with, it seems, in many of the areas that they're operating in, or force regimes to change to dilute these checks. One of the other things which, you know, we expect if we go into a cab or a private hire car is that we have an expectation of how much we are likely to pay, how much we are going to pay per mile, how much we have to pay in terms of waiting times. In terms of Uber, and maybe I'm a little bit naive, what's the arrangement for payment, and how could anybody be sure that they're not being conned, and how could we deal with that in terms of legislation?
I will highlight, Chair, that private hire cars do not fulfil the same regulatory requirements as taxis, but the point is absolutely appropriate. Uber publishes its fare. it decides upon its fare on a competitive basis and will often set a base fare below that of taxis. In fact, it makes a point of being lower than tariff. Tariff is a very fine system for taxis because it is a distinct and clear measurement of cost, unequivocal. Uber's fare seeks to mirror that, at least in the first view. In the first view, it is a defined distance and time cost. And actually, it differs in that you pay both distance and time, rather than the taxi tariff, which is distance or time, depending upon circumstance. But Uber also practices something which it calls surge pricing. And for those, a very brief description, a surge price is a change in price from tariff, from base fare, above base fare, in what Uber describes as a method of ensuring supply. That is its claim. Surge prices is not just a little bit more, it's many multiples of fare. And you will see reference in many press statements as to seven times fare. You're not obliged to accept it, so you are effectively not being conned, but it is the price of accepting service. I mean, you accept it or you don't get a trip. It's that simple. If you compare the claimed driver income, which is set as almost, don't work for us and you get this amount of money, with the numbers of trips and base fare, it appears to me a driver would not make the money that is suggested. In other words, there is a requirement at some point that surge pricing is put into effect. It's not an option, it's not an accident of supply. It would appear to be an intentional policy to massage the market or to profit maximise on the basis of the ability to do so. That is purely an interpretation. It is a reasonable statement that fares differ in terms of specific points of demand, and that is the basis of nighttime fares as opposed to tariff too. So additional fares in the taxi industry is related to the assurance of supply. That's not an unreasonable argument, but in practice it appears to me to be not only a necessary application, but also one that seeks to profit maximise.
You said at the very beginning of that statement that in terms of the charging regime, private car cars are not the same as Hackney. And yet, in the city of Aberdeen, which I represent, if I order a taxi by phone, I may get a yellow plate Hackney cab, I may get a red plate private hire car, and the charging regime is exactly the same. So could you clarify for me, are you meaning that there may be differences in some areas but not in other areas of the country in terms of that charging regime?
That's the correct interpretation, and I'm aware of Aberdeen's.
And it's up to each individual licensing area to decide what the situation is in that regard at this moment in time?
Yes.
Do you think that in itself may be cause of some difficulty?
I believe that local regulation is an appropriate position in terms of fares. They reflect local circumstances and local costs. We have a regime that bases the fare upon a measured consideration of the costs of production, and that is by definition a local activity. You may choose to define local as being a city, or you may seek to have it as a country if it is it is still related to the measurable costs. There is one aspect in terms of cost that may be worth touching on briefly. The taxi fare models of which I am aware, and particularly those in Glasgow and Edinburgh and in Inverness, and I believe Aberdeen as well, include an element called driver's wages, or the amount that the driver takes home after everything else has gone. Now, in any instance where that exists and a market shift occurs where somebody else joins the market, any additional services reducing income are likely to result in an increase in tariff to maintain that level.
I've got one other question about local flexibility before I bring in Willie Coffey, and that's round about the distinction that exists between Hackney licences and private hire car licences in most areas, where a private hire car licensee would not normally have to sit a knowledge test, and yet a Hackney cab driver would, of course, have to sit that knowledge test. Aberdeen has a situation where if you apply for a private hire car, you also have to sit that knowledge test, which means that there's really no distinction between private hire plate and a Hackney plate. Does that happen anywhere else in the country? And does that local distinction cause any tensions at all?
I'm not aware of the approach of every authority, so I cannot give you a definitive answer. I believe that the primary distinction between taxi and PHC relates to street pickup. The knowledge test, or the ability to control drivers of any vehicle type, appears to be an appropriate control and power of any authority. In terms of conflict, the only place I can identify is that really being in conflict is on the boundary of authority, one authority to another, where your trip may cross an authority boundary and therefore give you a choice of one system or another. It is my belief that assurance of driver safety and ability is a very, very logical and desirable outcome. Whether that requires a knowledge test or not currently sits in the power of the authority making the regulation, and I'm not sure how I could answer better than to say that that should be based on the circumstances of the location.
Thank you. Willie Coffey, please.
Thanks very much, Convener, and good morning to you, Dr. Cooper. As a former software engineer, I look at things like applications as being a positive step, positive development for the customer. So, I mean, it would come as a worry to myself, and I'm sure to others, if the application of this technology was providing opportunities for loopholes or illegality. Is that what you're seeing here from what I've heard so far? And in terms of established taxi companies, if you like, what are they doing, in your view, to catch up and deploy the varieties of technology that we've heard about this morning? And is that a way that they might overcome this threat that you've described to us?
Firstly, I do agree that the technology itself is a good thing. It provides access that has not existed before, makes this market sector more attractive to its users, and increases the number of trips being made in the sector. All of those are very, very positive. The taxi industry was slow to respond. They are late entrants to the application concept. And while the local companies have got a quality product mirroring many of the benefits of the market leader has one legal distinction and one less legal distinction that makes it an advantageous choice to the user. The legal distinction is that it is a multinational product that works across cities regardless of where you are. You get off your train or your aeroplane and your app works. You do not need to seek out a local app, which is a cost to the user. The slightly less legal one is that it allows for access to a variety of service types that the traditional taxi company's app does not. that being whether you sit in the PHC or in the taxi or in the rideshare TNC category. The user may well not be aware of the legality of the choice that they make. And I believe that may be intentional.
I see. And how would we overcome that? By just defining types of use that the applications could provide services for? Or how would you overcome that?
One of the greatest marketing coups of this particular discussion is the move, is the categorization of pundits, of commentary, those providing commentary, to either love or hate the app, to have an emotional attachment to the app. And I love many apps. They do a lot for me. But this discussion doesn't fit in emotion. Why I make that comment is that many responses fall into the "I hate this" category, or "I love it," or you know, that courts can be stylized as being anti-technology, anti-free market. Even I mean, it becomes fundamental to the core of market operation. That the responses to prevent access, which is our most recent response seen in Spain, preclude access, bring with it very large question marks over free market operation, the ability for a market to operate, because they have taken such an extreme measure, because such an extreme measure appears to be the only one that has any effect. I caution against the outright banning of something that brings benefit. I can't see a very good intermediate step, because so far most intermediate steps have been, in reality, ineffective.
Okay. Food for thought there, certainly. Could I switch the conversation slightly, convener, to...
Sure.
Just to take advantage of your experience, Dr. Cooper, there's an example in the media this morning of a person, a driver, let's say of dubious reputation, who was able to move from one authority to another to evade his record, for example, in one authority, and basically lie about his circumstances prior to that and gain a licence in another authority. Have you got any view about how we could and should close that loophole to protect the public? You know?
One of the strongest arguments, one of the strongest opportunities to ensure there is no licensed tourism, if you wish, is to maintain a relationship to Police Scotland in the fit and proper person test, in the ways that we identify criminal backgrounds, and that is a correct and proper outcome of the regulatory structure as it stands. I mean, I'm not aware of the instance to which you refer, but part of the structure of an authority being the competent authority to determine is that that test is at least possible, if not always applied or always effectively applied. When you lose control to third parties, that opportunity and that certainty is lost as well. Now, you may hear arguments that the third parties actually do a better job, and that's certainly one that we've seen in some United States cities, where the authority would seek FBI fingerprinting. The third parties, however good they may be, need to have some relationship to authority, to regulation that is sustainable, and I don't believe that that is where they are at this point in time. The short answer is that the competent authority has to be associated with and approved by government, even if it is not government itself.
Probably the problem is where the person sought to evade his record, and is there an opportunity here in terms of software and applications and so on for that kind of information to be shared amongst licensing board so that a person cannot evade detection and to reveal their past history, perhaps?
There's a great deal of opportunity. I'm not sure that the will is there to use it. And in this instance, it is not just the technology as we currently see it, it's the potential of that technology to provide a linked-up service. As a researcher, and actually in my role in commissions for regulatory commissions, I would strongly seek to have information fed to me or to the authority from the applications. So far, although there is one instance where it's getting a little bit more friendly, so far the new technology companies have not provided any such feedback, despite the obvious benefit of that feedback being made available.
Mention that point from John Wilson, please.
If you don't mind, just to follow up on that, Dr. Cooper, you referred to the competent authority. I think Mr. Coffey's example is quite a good one, whereby if someone making application for a car, a license car, decides not to apply to one authority because they have been told that authority's regime of application is a lot tougher and takes cognizance of, say, reports from Police Scotland. Whereas a neighbouring authority, the licensing committee may not be as stringent in their application of the rules in relation to applying for a license. What would you say in those circumstances, and how can we ensure that there is a even playing field being applied by licensing committees throughout Scotland?
The example you give feels to me like a failure in one of the licensing authorities to fully take advantage of national information on drivers. I mean, I'm not aware of the example.
Does that fully take in the opportunity, or is it, are they failing to comply with what they should be doing legally?
I don't know the answer to that, okay. I'm afraid.
Just to try and clarify that point, my understanding is that if a Police Scotland report appears before a committee, licensing committee, the committee can take cognizance of that report or set that report aside at the present time. Is that the situation?
I can only assume that it is from what you say. I do not know what the extent to which it can be put aside. I mean, that is something that of which I'm not aware. The question you pose is can we level the playing field for other groups? The answer is no. We are in the best position that we can be where there is a Police Scotland report of which cognizance is taken. Where that decision is given or assumed by a party that does not go through licensing, then there is no way of assuring a level playing field.
Willie? Okay. Was yours on this point, Alec? In which case, I'll take Claire first, please. Claire Adamson.
Thank you very much, Dr. Cooper. Different subject from what we've covered already this morning. The Scottish Government have stated that they believe that services run by the community, social enterprises, voluntary services such as cancer transport services should not be included, should still be exempt from the higher car licensing regime. Do you agree with their position for these organisations?
Mr. Cooper?
I have no view that I can give you helpfully. The only comment that may be helpful is, were these services to be contracted to the taxi or private hire car industry, I see no reason why they, private hire and taxis, should not abide by all existing regulations.
Okay, thank you. Alec Rowley, please.
Would it be fair to distinguish between the urban and rural areas of Scotland in terms of, I suppose, demand? I note, for example, in the evidence that's come in, where we look at the removal of the exemption for cars contracted for 24 hours or more, generally, whilst that's welcomed, there is a division, Cosla notes, between urban and rural authorities, where rural authorities are more concerned that that could lead to a withdrawal from the market. And I suppose that's really where I'm trying to touch on. Is there a major difference? You talk about Glasgow and Edinburgh and the big cities, but if you look at rural Scotland, there isn't the same demand and therefore supply.
No, they're not the same. Urban and rural are different, and the markets are different, and that is historically why we have rural locations with one form of taxi-type service and urban locations with two. In the evidence that I have for you related to market entrance and TNCs, there will be, I believe, very limited incursion or movement into rural areas by the TNCs simply because the market is not there for them. It's not a profitable venture. Do I see differences in as a result of the removal of the 24-hour? It's not a question I have had in the front of my mind. And one I have no prepared answer for. I apologise.
Okay. We'll maybe follow up with you later.
Okay.
Yeah.
Can I thank you very much for your evidence today, Dr. Cooper? That has been extremely useful. I now suspend for a few minutes for a change of witnesses. Thank you. We now move on to our second panel of witnesses. I'd like to welcome Kevin Woodburn of Edinburgh City Private Hire, Les McVay of CityCabs, and Bill McIntosh of the Scottish Taxi Federation. Would you like to make any opening remarks, gentlemen? Mr. McIntosh, please.
Thank you. Mr. Chairman, I wasn't entirely sure just what we were coming here for today. So I'm assuming that we are given evidence in regard to the issues that arise in the new bill in civic licensing. And I can be very brief in that respect. There is a clause, as you know, to remove, there is an option to remove clause 22C, which allows cars or vehicles and drivers to be hired on a 24-hour basis. And we support fully the removal of that particular clause because we have seen attempts by groups and bodies and one particular body who is public funded to use just such vehicles in an effort to get around the issue of licensing and the restrictions that are placed on them thereon. So as long as there is some loophole there to allow unlicensed activity, then there are some people who are quite willing to take that opportunity and drive a horse and coaches through that. So the Scottish Taxi Federation strongly support the removal of that that section. With regard to the matter of driver training being extended as an option to private hire cars and drivers, don't have any really hard feelings on it other than that and it is our view that it is unnecessary and it's going to become very, very burdensome for the local authorities involved. I know that my own local authority in Glasgow struggle to accommodate the number of taxi drivers that are applying to have the test before they are to be granted a licence, and I can only see that situation getting worse if they include private hire in there. I think as well that I know it's an option and councils may or may not use it, but I understand that in the responses to the government there was quite a high percentage of councils actually in favour of this. And I can also see that this is going to slow up the feed of drivers into the private hire sector and from there into the taxi business. The one that concerns us most is the option to allow councils to limit the number of private hire cars. Not that we object to the limitation of private hire cars in fact, what we're concerned about is that the option and the way it's been structured, and as much that they've decided rather than have unmet demand, then it's to be on the basis of over-provision. Now, I think Dr. Cooper alluded to it in his report that there is no measurement available at this time, and it's very difficult to imagine how there can be any measurement to understand that there are too many private hire cars in any one area. It's simple in terms of, it seems that this particular section has been taken from the Licence in Scotland Act 2005, and it's fairly simple to walk down a street in any particular city and see that there are 10 public houses there and you don't need another one. But it's an entirely different matter when you're trying to measure the number of private hire cars that are going to be available. And our major concern is that the financial memorandum particularly refers to the fact that there is likely to be many more court challenges in respect of this particular part of the legislation. And that not to worry about that, though, because that's going to come back to the licence fees that's being charged to the taxi and private hire trade. And I just don't think that we should be picking up the tab for what's an innate piece of legislation. The government really needs to find some other way of safeguarding councils from being dragged into court at every opportunity.
Probably tease some of this out in questioning, Mr. McIntosh.
Okay.
Mr. Woodburn, do you have any opening remarks that you'd like to make?
No, just to say thanks for inviting us this morning, and obviously I'm very interested to to answer some of the questions that may well get posed. So no real opening remarks.
Thank you. And Mr. McVay?
Yeah, I'd just like to say, although I've been asked for a more local aspect, and I'm not, Professor Cooper was more global, but I hope to give a more positive presentation about the taxi trade regarding what's being done within the taxi trade to meet competition and what measures we take to ensure that our drivers and vehicles are up to a certain standard.
Okay. Do you want to give us a brief overview of that just now?
Well, one of the things that Professor Cooper said, that we were slow to take up the app. We were offered the app by our service provider, and we signed up the day after, and we've had it for about 2 years now. We do actively advertise it on the radio in the back of the taxis, and recently we've got a TV advertisement on the local Edinburgh STV channel. So we actively add it, and it is growing. It's grown from zero to about 6,000 jobs a month now we use on the apps. But it's something the public has to take up themselves. Another question about the level of checks on the drivers. We, along with Central Radio Taxis, and I believe Edinburgh City Private Hire do it as well, we put all our drivers through the Protection Vulnerable Groups, and they go through that every 3 years. And we get a report back every 3 years for every driver that works with CityCabs. I know Central do that as well. So that's two-thirds of the Edinburgh trade check their drivers.
Going above and beyond the legislation that currently exists. Let's move on to that legislation as it stands, and you can talk about the proposed bill too in this regard. Do you think that the current differences in licensing between taxi and private hire cars are justified? Mr. McVay, do you want to start with that?
I'm actually been the service manager for the airport regarding the public hire rank for the last 7 years. And CityCabs, 2 years ago, were successful in winning the contract for 5 years, possibly seven. We sit alongside the private hire. Before that contract was awarded, the private hire sat behind the fence. It was Onward Travel, which was run by Comcabs. And the premise of that was they would go into a porter cabin and book a private hire car. And the booking was never made. It was just, it was a sham. Because it was behind a fence, nobody saw. This time round, the contract was renegotiated, but they came from behind the fence, and they actually sit alongside the public hire, and the public have a choice. So they come to, we have a rank, the private hire can't officially call it a rank, but they have an area where they rank up, and the public have a choice. Now, that suits the purpose of perhaps you're coming into Edinburgh, you want a black taxi, the knowledge, but also if somebody's going to Gleneagles, there's a group of people, they're playing golf, they've got the golf clubs, they've got the suitcase, they want a people carrier, they want a saloon car, which is perceived to be a little bit more comfortable, but people do have a choice, and that's what Edinburgh Airport required.
From an Edinburgh perspective, Bill McIntosh, do you want to give us the national perspective? Because, I think that sometimes it's very difficult for the public to get their head around the differences between the two regimes. Do you think that the current differences are justified?
That evolved with the advent of the 1982 Act, as I'm sure you're aware. And it's been running since then, and over that period of time there's been a lot of confusion built up, not the least of which caused by the media, who constantly refer to everything as a taxi because they see the word taxi as being a generic term. The fact is, my colleague has mentioned freedom of choice, and the current two-tier regime gives the public that choice, and for that reason, above all else, I feel it's very justified in hanging on to where we're at just now.
Okay, Mr. Woodburn.
Thank you, Chair. I think the honest answer to the question is that it hinges on where you're coming at the answer to the question from, in the sense that you have a distinct difference in the two trades, albeit there's a two-tier licensing system, and there are areas of convergence within that, similarities in terms of doing the jobs. But there are distinct differences, and I think you have to understand the historical differences that come to the forefront every single day out there on the streets for drivers. And a lot of it hinges around what is it that we really wanted with a two-tier licensing system? If we go back in time, if we could speak to the people that actually put the legislation in place originally, what was their purpose? Was their purpose to have two forms of transportation, two forms of taxi-like situations? And if that were the case, why then has over the years the whole thing been eroded? Because now what you have is, you have, and this will be slightly controversial to my two colleagues either side here, but you have a situation where you have public hire vehicles, taxis, to all intents and purposes. Taxis originally were designed to do what? To ply for hire, which is why private hire was brought in, because it cannot ply for hire. That's the two differences between the two trades, effectively. So therefore, if you have one sector of the trade, which is pre-booked hires only, why would you have the other sector, which was designed as public hire, therefore allowed to then do pre-booked hire work? And that's where the whole thing got blurred, and that's where it all changed. And over the years, it's continued down that path. And now you've got a situation where you're being asked questions about, do you think there's a single-tier licensing system, a two-tier licensing system? The truth is, I don't really think it matters that much anymore, if I'm being honest, because at the end of the day, it'll be the market that dictates. It'll be the public. And with all due respect to this committee and various other committees that I've sat in front of and been questioned of, I think what gets lost in all of this is that, it's about the public. It's the public who will decide what they want. We can talk about apps all day long. We can talk about, what we do as companies all day long. The public will decide whether they use us as companies. The public are not stupid. And they'll make their decisions based on whatever factors are important to them in whatever area of the country they live in, whether it be rural, whether it be in the centre of Glasgow, in the centre of Edinburgh. They'll decide based on what's on offer to them. And I think that gets lost sometimes.
You said that the market will decide, and Mr. McIntosh talked about provision in the bill for the limitation of private hire car licences. And yet we see, without the bill actually reaching the point of legislation, that a number of authorities are already using the 1982 Act in terms of limiting the amount of licences, maybe to the detriment of the general public, who are not being fully served. So do you think that your comment, and I'll ask all of you, your comment about the market deciding often is not the case because of the limitations that are put in place by a licensing authority? And do you think that there are any areas, and I know that you can probably talk only about your own locales, any areas that are not being particularly well served at this moment in time because of possible misapplication of the 1982 Act? And do you think that the new legislation may help in that regard? Or is it the case that some of the things which are in place and could be in place make it easier for the entry of Uber and others because the market is not being served? Mr. Woodburn, if you would like to start.
I'm trying to remember all aspects of the various
very
points
long,
in the one
sorry.
Question there. I think at the end of the day, the market being served, if you like, in respect of the proposals in the bill to change. The ceiling, for want of a better description, on private hire, the local authorities having the power to decide within their own locale whether or not private hire should have a ceiling or not, I think, and other colleagues out there within the private hire sector would probably disagree with me, but I will give you my own personal opinion on it. I don't necessarily think that's a bad thing. I think there's a lot of what you've heard so far today. I would, without being too nasty about it, there's a lot of scaremongering out there within the taxis to private hire trade. The things that have been discussed today with the app, for example, there's a lot of misunderstandings out there. Mr. Wilson pointed out something earlier on which I thought was very, very relevant, in that we seem to be targeting Uber and the apps as the sort of big bad wolf coming over the hill, but nobody's actually asked the big bad wolf are they a big bad wolf? And if Uber want to come into this marketplace and do some of the nasty things that's being described of them, why have they even applied for a booking office license then? Why have they not just said, you know what, we'll just start taking bookings and we won't comply with the legislation that's already in place in the country that we're going into? But they have. So I think a lot of what goes on within the trade is scaremongering. And being honest, from the trade itself, the trade is as guilty as anybody for causing these situations. And the legislation is already in place. If a company who takes bookings must have a booking office license and has a booking office license and then supplies unlicensed vehicles, then guess what? The license will be taken away by the relevant authority, whether it be Edinburgh, Glasgow, West Lothian, who's represented here today. All of these things are already in place. And I don't really think that, you know, it's a question of, yeah, we need to change legislative issues in some areas, but some of the areas that are already in place, it's how they've been twisted over the years that causes the problem. And again, going back in time and asking the people who put the legislation in place in the first place, what were they actually trying to do, might give everybody a clearer picture.
Mr. McVay, please.
Personal local level, I would disagree that there's any scaremongering regarding Uber from Edinburgh taxi companies or the public hire trade. I'm aware of Uber. I know their working practice. I know their strengths and I know their weaknesses as well. And one of their weaknesses will be the price surging that they adapt. There's two situations that I know of in Sydney where it was the Sydney when the seed was in progress and there was a surge of vehicles being required, whether it was public hire or private hire or Uber. And what happens in their system, they have an automatic algorithm that just kicks in. And if the surge goes up to a certain level, it then kicks in, as Professor Cooper has already mentioned, it goes up 1, 2, 3, 4 times. And in Sydney, it went up 4 times to take these people away from that area, the regular customers. I was also sent an email in Hugmanay from Sydney, a guy that lives over there, and he uses Uber. And all their customers were sent an email prior to the Hugmanay celebrations, and it warned them and it showed them a graph when the price surge would come into effect, 11:30 right through to 4 o'clock. And it warned them a normal $30 fare would go up to over $100. And they asked them to form groups and to share vehicles. So that's the level that they're coming into the market, and that's how they price. And I've watched the guy who runs Uber, Travers, forget his second name. And he justifies that. He justifies it along the lines, if you book a hotel during peak times, the price goes up. That's how he justifies it. And he tries to also justify it by getting vehicles from outworth areas to come in to travel, to go to that area to pick up taxis. Now, how the public will respond to that in Edinburgh, I don't think they'll take to that too kindly if they're going to be charged 2 or 3 times just because the service is failing them. I think the taxi trade is quite strong in Edinburgh. And I'll give you another example. If you're driving with Uber as a driver, you're charged 20%. So if somebody books a taxi, they pay up front, they pay through their credit card, Uber keep 20%, the driver gets the 80%. Currently, in Edinburgh, we have two strong associations, Central and CityCabs, and all the drivers are part of that. All the members actually own a share of the company. And it's not a non-profit organisation. And what I know this is quite flexible, depending on how many hours, but what we try and work out is that a driver will probably pay 10%. Of every fare that he gets from City Cabs or probably Central, he'll pay 10%. You go with Uber, you'll pay 20%. So these things, I think, the market in Edinburgh, and especially the taxis, I think have moved considerably over the last few years. We've become more responsible. We adapt. We incorporate all the latest technology. We were the first ones to get GPRS. And I know it's maybe not answering one of your questions, but one of the things while I've got in my mind, I would just like to point out, again, in a positive way, if Uber come in and start taking if there's an incident regarding a passenger or other such like, who's responsible? At the moment, what happens is, if there's a police inquiry, the police come to the door of the taxi companies, whatever hour of the day. We give them full access to all of our information. Every taxi is monitored, it's tracked. We know every turn that taxi driver makes. And we're involved in solving quite a few crimes in the Edinburgh area over recent times. And I know Central and Comcabs offer that service as well. Who would do that if it was Uber?
Mr. McIntosh, please.
I'm afraid I've lost the thread of your question.
Okay, it was roundabout market deciding, and at this moment in time, does the market really decide with the restrictions that can be put in place by local licensing authorities? And do those restrictions maybe make it easier for the likes of Uber to enter the market?
Well, there could well be. There could be an argument there that it is making it easier for Uber to enter the market. But I disagree with my colleague. You'll be surprised to hear that we need a different type of system. I think the system that we have just now is tried and tested. It's worked very well since 1982, and it's still working very well. Taxis are supply both types of service, the radio and the street service, and the street service is unlikely to discontinue, so I can see that there is going to be a need for the foreseeable future to retain a two-tier system, and that's the way I would like to see it go.
Okay, obviously, Mr. McIntosh, you represent a national body. You say you operate in Glasgow. Other two gentlemen are from Edinburgh. Do you think that throughout the country, in each of the 32 licensing authorities, do you think that the market is well served by the licensing regimes that are currently in place?
The short answer is for the most part, yes.
For the most part, yes. Thank you very much. Cara Hilton, please.
Yeah, just sort of linking in with the discussion we've just had, Bill McIntosh said that the system at the moment is tried and tested, but I wonder what your observations would be on Dr. Cooper's comments that the market is transforming in such a way that the two-tier licensing regime might be very difficult to enforce in future, and that we could be heading towards a sort of monopolistic provider. I'd be interested in the panel's take on those comments from Mr. Cooper.
Shall we start with Mr. McVay first, please?
Monopolistic as in Uber or private hire taking over public hire taking over private hire. I think they work well. I mean, Uber will come. The only thing I would ask is Mr. Wilson mentioned, if they're coming, they're only allowed to use licensed drivers and licensed vehicles. In some areas in America, they use just people who download their app, an unlicensed and an unlicensed vehicle. That just is a horror story as far as I'm concerned. But Uber, again, will come, and it's up to us to pull our socks up and get on our toes and provide a better service. There's nobody looking for a monopoly. Again, it's up to the drivers, whether it's public hire or private hire. There's a situation where CityCabs have a taxi school, and about 40% of the people coming to us to sit the test are private hire drivers. You know, it's the next level up. They want to get the public car. I don't know if Kevin will disagree with this, but they go into the private hire because it's easier to go into the private hire. They don't have to sit the brief. They might have no knowledge of Edinburgh City, so they'll go in and they'll study and drive for private hire as well. Some stay with private hire. We've got guys who've left the public hire and went to the private hire because it suited them. But again, going back to the choice, sometimes there is a line where choice becomes confusion, and some people get confused, and we see that at the airport every day. People like the choice, but other people get confused, and I don't know how you would legislate against that.
Mr. Woodburn, please.
Very similar to Les in that respect, in that, you know, I touched on Uber earlier, on Uber's coming. Whether or not we like that or not is, to be quite frank, irrelevant. You know, they're a company that's coming into the Edinburgh area, coming into the Glasgow area, and as long as they play by the same rules as everybody else and the obvious legislation applies, then okay, that's fine. It's competition. The difference with Uber is that Uber are different from every other company out there, in that Uber don't actually have any vehicles on their circuit, if you like. What they do is they come into a city and try and attract all of the vehicles who are already working in that city, in private hire terms anyway, not in Hackney terms. And they try and get them to associate themselves with the Uber app as a driver on the app. So we've got something like 500 drivers in our company. All of those 500 could join Uber and stay with us. And at the sort of downtime, if you like, where we're maybe busy and they're quiet, or you know they're busy and we're quiet, the driver will try and feed into both systems. That, in effect, is what this app is about on the driver's side, not on the public side. But as long as the rules are the same, and it's licensed vehicles that are being supplied and licensed drivers. I don't think you'll ever get a monopolistic situation. It will come back down to, as Liz touched on, it will come back down to price. And yes, there are parameters within the pricing structure, and there are things that can be done on both sides of the trade. Whether or not they would want to do them would be entirely up to the individual companies as to what they want to do. But the monopolistic side of things, I doubt very much that the public would ever have a monopolistic situation when it comes to sub-pricing, for example, and 4 and 7 times the price. Would anybody in this room pay that? No. No, why? Because we all know there are choices. Just because you use somebody once doesn't mean to say you've got to use them 10 times over and you've got to pay whatever it is they want to charge you. Because we all know there are choices out there. And that's the way it should be, that there are choices out there. And again, touching on the single or, you know, two-tier licensing system, you could argue the point that there are choices because of the two-tier system. But I think the whole thing, it might change, it might not change. And at the end of the day, I think there's reasons why it probably should, and there's reasons why it maybe shouldn't. But it's going to come down to choice, and it's going to come down to, you know, choice of different types of vehicles. And you touched on it. Does the legislation allow for the market to decide? Very difficult question to answer.
Mr. McIntosh, please.
Well, I disagree with Dr. Cooper's view that Uber or any other app company, for that matter, will finish up in a monopolistic situation. I think that what we need to be more concerned about with these app suppliers is that they comply with the current legislation. And right now, it would look, at least if you see the various articles that are available on YouTube and some other sites, that they currently don't comply with the legislation in other countries. That may well be different here, but that's the main concern that the taxi industry have. There's a huge potential with these type of companies for unlicensed activity, and I think the government has to find some way of legislating for that. We've already suggested that the booking office legislation might be one way of doing it, and not necessarily changing the legislation, but by making more mandatory conditions which would bring people like Uber under the current legislation that's available.
Thank you. Cara, do you want to come back in?
No, that was very helpful.
Thank you very much. I want to touch upon something I did earlier. Mr. McVay said that some of the private hire drivers use your training school because they want to complete the knowledge. Yeah. So in Edinburgh, private hire car drivers don't have to complete a knowledge test.
No. They don't have to. No, don't have to.
There's no obligation to do so. Is that the same in most local authorities areas, do you know?
To my knowledge, yes. I think potentially Aberdeen's maybe.
Aberdeen is the anomaly in all of this,
yeah. Mm-hmm.
Which is causing me the difficulties that I am. So in terms of the application of the 1982 Act, Aberdeen is the only place that is currently making private hire car drivers sit the knowledge test.
Making them, yes. There are other areas of the country where the individual companies, my own company, for example, we have our own training school. We choose to train our drivers. We choose to take them to whatever standard we feel is the appropriate standard for the marketplace that we are in. And when it comes to the legislative side of things, I, again, from a company perspective, I have no fear of there being legislation of the training of drivers. My concern, my slight concern, would be that are we talking about training a private hire driver to the same level as a taxi driver? And if that is the case, is it just about knowledge? Or is it as much about the other modules that perhaps a taxi driver has to look at, you know, health and safety, that type of training, wheelchair, disability, discrimination, bits and pieces. All of those things are important if that's what we're talking about in training. Now, again, as far as I understand it, we're only talking about, in terms of the bill, knowledge training.
Thank you very much, Mr. Woodburn. That's very useful. Cameron Buchanan, please.
Thank you very much, Bernard. You touched on the fact that you wanted a level playing field. What do you think of the two-tier system then? Would you change that with the private hire? And also, because the difference with the private hire is you don't have to have the knowledge in the same way, and you also, there's no buying and selling of a plate like there is in the Hackney cabs. Would you change that system at all? Would you be in favour? I didn't gather from your replies that you would be, that you wanted competition, but do you think it should alter in any way? I gathered that from your reply at the beginning.
It's a very difficult one to answer because at the end of the day, there are parts of the legislation which I do think currently a two-tier system works well. There are other aspects to it which I don't necessarily agree that they do work well. But again, depending on the new legislation and what, and again, it's not clear as to what exactly is being proposed here. As an example, the numbers game, if you like, and the capping of private hire, allowing local authorities to cap them in any given area. Okay, that's fine. And depending on the test that is applied to get the number correct, if everybody agrees in that local area that that's the correct way to go about deciding the numbers, then fine. But what's the next stage? Is the next stage then that the plate then becomes transferable? Are we then talking about incorporation of private hire plates, which then can then be sold on for a value? Or are we saying, no, that's not to happen on this occasion because it's private hire? So in other words, we're back into a situation where private hire and Hackney are treated differently. And that's my concern about all of these things, is that it's the local authority interpretation of what happens next that concerns me.
Excuse me. Do you think it's a good idea to keep this sort of control within the local authorities, or would you suggest some other way?
I think, again, there's a case to be made for keeping it under the control of the local authorities because they're the ones that best know their own local environment, as long as those local authorities are not concerning themselves with the particular vested interest groups that are lobbying them stronger than other groups that may not be lobbying them as strongly. So I have concerns about all of these things. But again, slightly more controversial, perhaps.
Okay, so in terms of the 1982 Act, which doesn't allow for capping, we already see capping going on in certain local authority areas when it comes to private hire car. Do we not?
No, not to my knowledge.
Is it not the case that Aberdeen has a cap?
Well, again, I'm not intimate when it comes to the
I'm being a bit parochial here, but I
don't think legally they can put a cap on at this point in time. They can't say we cannot issue any more private hire licences, not to my understanding of the legislation as it currently stands.
Thank you, Mr. Woodburn. Cameron, do you want to come back?
Just a moment. They can't, did you say, legislators to how many private hire cars?
Today, not to my understanding, no.
Right.
No.
The bill
not when it comes
that.
To private hire licences.
The bill does
no.
that, I know. The bill does that. But the moment it doesn't stand.
No. The proof, the test of that would be to go and pick up the phone now to Aberdeen Council and ask, can I put a private hire plate on? And if they say yes, then there's your answer.
Thank you.
Thank you. That's fine.
Yep.
Thank you.
John Wilson, please.
Thank you, Convener. Just to pick up on a couple of responses we've heard so far, and I just want clarification from Mr. Woodburn in terms of the issue and the private hire drivers signing up for Uber. Because you gave the impression that private hire car drivers from say private hire could actually sign up for Uber as well as being members of Edinburgh City Private Hire. Is that what you're implying?
I'm implying or I'm stating that the way that Uber works is they come into a marketplace and they attract drivers who are already in the marketplace who are perhaps with other companies. If we have drivers, for example, in our company, we have two different types of drivers. We have owner drivers, guys who own their own vehicle and pay us a fee, if you like, for the work that we provide them. And we have what I would class as rental drivers who drive company vehicles that we supply to them. And the difficulty for us with the Uber scenario is that there is no way I could easily enforce an owner driver in not covering work, if you like, for Uber or any other company for that matter. I've maybe got a slightly more stronger hand, if you like, when it comes to our own vehicles that we supply to drivers, that we can specify, well, look, you cannot do work for anybody else. But the way the legislation is currently, a private hire driver can work for 10 companies today if he chooses to. It's just having access to the work that those companies have. Or he can work for no companies, and he can work for himself. And he can take bookings himself without having to have a booking office licence. So
Woodburn, for that clarification, but our understanding, and it might be the misconception in terms of the public material that's out there, is that Uber come in and recruit non-licensed drivers.
They did.
Let me finish, Mr. Woodburn. Non-licensed drivers, non-licensed cars. And the examples that have been given from other jurisdictions, worldwide jurisdictions, is they tend to attract individuals rather than existing drivers, whether that be private hire or hackney cab drivers, to operate the service. Would that not be a major worry for both the black hack companies as well as the private hire companies, if Uber were to come in and say, we're not going to recruit or use any of the existing licensed cars or drivers, we are going to recruit publicly to actually build our own business that has no current association with any of the licensed drivers or licensed cars?
Would that be a concern? Yes, of course, and I would suggest it would be more of a concern to the public than it would be to the trade, because I don't honestly believe for one second that the public would stand for unlicensed drivers and unlicensed cars running around the city picking them up at 2 and 3 in the morning. I can't see it happening. I genuinely can't see it happening. And again, my understanding is that I don't want to sit here and sound as though I'm a fan of Uber. I'm trying very, very difficult to, or sorry, trying very, very hard to sit on the fence and be objective on this. But at the end of the day, my understanding is that Uber or companies like Uber would be coming into a marketplace and trying to recruit, for want of a better word, licensed drivers with licensed vehicles. Were it not to be the case, we would all be standing here objecting vehemently to any allowance of any company coming into the sector that ran unlicensed drivers and unlicensed cars. And we'd be the first to be stand up and object to it. But I think the public would be very, very close behind us.
Mr. Woodburn, you also made reference to the booking office scenario.
Yes.
And that Uber would have to operate a booking office. At the present moment, my understanding is if you operate a taxi firm, whether that be private hire or black hack, you have your booking office in the local authority that is actually you're located and licensed from. Uber, as I understand it, is an app system, wouldn't have 32 booking offices throughout Scotland to coincide with the licensing authority. They'd be looking, if they had a booking office at all, to have one operational centre with the app applied to the whole of Scotland. How do you think that fits in with the current legislation and the proposed legislation whereby booking offices are associated with the licensing authority?
If you were correct, and I'm not suggesting that you're not, I don't know the facts, but I can tell you my version of what I think is the situation. But if you were correct, I think that would be a huge problem if Uber were to come in and basically run one, if you like, centre encompassing all 32 licensing authorities, and I think the licensing authorities themselves would have a major problem with that. But that is not my understanding of what's actually going to be happening here. As far as I am aware, at this precise moment in time, Uber have applied for a booking office licence for Edinburgh to run an office in George Street somewhere, and they've applied for a booking office licence for Glasgow. Now, that would suggest to me that if they were looking to come into other areas of Scotland, they'd apply for booking office licences within those specific licensing authority areas. But I'm not Uber, so it might be a good idea that, you know, they're spoken to as a company. But that's my understanding anyway.
John.
Mr. McVay or Mr. McIntosh, any comments on?
Well, my understanding is that they've got to apply for whatever city they're operating from for a booking office licence in that area. That's the current legislation. And again, if they were to move to using unlicensed vehicles and unlicensed drivers, I think that would be a major concern for Police Scotland as well, I would have thought. And you would have a movement gradually over a period of time of nobody coming in and sitting their brief or nobody going into the private hire sector. I think in Edinburgh at the moment, we have a very, very good market. It's competitive. It's to a point now where there's nobody queuing up for either public hire licences or private hire licences. And that's, I would suggest, is market forces. And I think that's what everybody's looking for. it's a good example of what happens. And if there is a surge at any place, then people will come in and they'll look to buy public hire licences or private hire licences. But at the moment, there's no movement. And I think that's two reasons. Well, one, the Edinburgh City Council employ Halcro to have surveys every 3 years for unmet demand, and that gauges it. Again, it's, I don't know, bang the drum for Edinburgh, but it's a very good, healthy market. And I am not, I'm aware of Uber, and I'm aware of Uber's strength, and I'm aware of Uber's weaknesses. And for me, the Edinburgh trade, both private hire and public hire, have to step up and meet the challenge. That's where the real situation will develop. Regarding, and again, what Kevin said before, the public will decide. The public will decide if they want to get into a vehicle and get charged three or four times the amount. I can speak for practical times. I'm not going to, I know the time, but we have a situation in Edinburgh where at Christmas and New Year time, the festive time, we will implement a tariff four. Now, we lose work through that tariff four because it goes up to a certain level, I believe. You know, it was introduced several years ago to try and bring the supply up to meet the demand. All it has is reduced demand during that level. And we see a drop. We're trying through the tariff review to visit that tariff four and maybe bring it down to a reasonable level to get our customers back, because that's at the time of year they most use us or they most need us. We're overpricing. So again, that's something we're looking at to try and get that back down again.
Mr. McIntosh, please.
Sorry, could you repeat your question again, please?
John.
Was that long ago? I forgot myself. It was really about the situation with Uber and the coming in terms of the booking offices, with the location of booking offices, and other issues around that, and the recruitment of unlicensed drivers and cars, and whether that's an issue for your members in relation
well,
to...
Well, it's obviously be an issue for our members. I would imagine it also be an issue for local authorities, because the booking office legislation is quite clear. It applies to every local authority in Scotland. So it's difficult for me to foresee why Uber would be able to operate in Dundee from an office that was based in Edinburgh. I think that would be a major concern, and they would be breaching the terms of the legislation as far as Dundee is concerned.
Can I just seek clarification in terms of a booking office? How does that booking office get registered with the licensing board? Because my fear is that Uber could say, we have got an operator, one operator, operating from a housing estate in Dundee, and that's the booking office. That's what they register as a booking office. Because in effect, they don't need somebody at the end of the telephone, because the app, the computerised system, will do that all for them. So do you think there should be any guidance or any regulations put in place to say that a booking office should be operating in such a way? Because most of the bookings will be, as I said, will be done through the app. The drivers will use a smartphone rather than a radio controlled system. So how do we make sure that the 32 people employed throughout Scotland are not the limit to Uber's involvement or any other companies similar to Uber operation of services in this 32 licensing board authorities?
Let's start with Mr. McIntosh, please.
Well, it's a very difficult question to answer, and I hear what you're saying, that Uber could in effect have booking offices in 32 areas which in effect are not working. The fact of the matter is that Uber could probably run their operation from the Netherlands or anywhere else if they chose, because it's all done in cyberspace. It's a very difficult question, and it's very difficult for me as just an ordinary individual to answer what's required in terms of legislation.
Mr. Woodburn.
I agree with Bill to an extent. We are so-called experts in our field, experts based on 25, 30 years' experience in the particular sector that we are in. Some would say replace expert with dinosaur, because at the end of the day, you know, essentially that's what it's all based around, the fact that we've had lengthy time in a certain trade. But when it comes to the specifics of the question, there is absolutely nothing in terms of the checks and balances that are already currently in place in each individual licensing authority to ensure that the rules are being applied accordingly. And some of the stupidity, if you like, of the situations that we are currently in, when you have local cab inspectors who can do nothing about a particular situation that they know is going on because the company concerned that's involved in it is not a licensed company, he has no remit to even go and speak to them because they're a non-licensed company. So in terms of Mr. Wilson's hypothetical, if you like, situation there, yes, there are concerns and great concerns as to whether or not these things may apply in the future. But as trade people, we just have to hope that the legislation is being acted upon, that is in place, and that at the point where, if it needs to change, that it's changed quickly. My concern is that, you know, we still work on a Civic Government Scotland Act from 1982. And we're talking about little bits of changes here and little bits of changes there. Now, I fully understand that, you know, in the greater scheme of things in the country, taxi licensing, private hire licensing is nowhere near the top of the tree. Of course, it shouldn't be. But for us, it is. It is the top of our tree. So, you know, we have to fight.
Of our tree as well, Mr. Woodburn.
I'll go off the tree then.
Mr. McVay.
When we applied for our booking office licence, we received a visit from the Council and Police Scotland, and I think we've had two checks since then. I think it's been going for 4 or 5 years now. So we do get site visits from the police to look at our system, and they know it anyway because they're up there every second weekend. But again, Uber, if you want, has been quite responsible in saying that they've applied for, because currently, just now, going around the ranks in Edinburgh, there's a company called Get Taxi. And they're trying to get our drivers to download their app to take work. Again, I don't think there's been too big a take-up. I can imagine some streetcars would take it up during this quiet period and trial it. Again, it's just choice. And that, they don't have a booking office, and that's the problem. That's where the cyberspace comes in, or the legislation requires that company. They haven't made any effort to get a booking office licence, yet they're out there going around the ranks at the moment. And we've saw this twice before over the last maybe year to 18 months, where companies have came up and tried to get drivers, and there's very little uptake on it. Again, two-thirds of the drivers, owners in Edinburgh, the public car, belong to a circuit, either CityCabs, Central or Comcabs. And street cars basically are street cabs for a reason. They don't want to be part of a radio company or perhaps an app company. It depends. But going back to choice, but there is that difficulty where who applies for a booking office license. Uber have, Get Taxi haven't, and the two previous ones, and I forget their names, who went round the ranks and tried to promote the business, they disappeared as quick as they appeared. What was it? No, it wasn't Halo. It wasn't.
It's
Halo.
Not. The other companies aren't really relevant to us. So, if you want to send us them later, it's fine.
I'm just saying an example that, you know, yeah. Uber actually have applied for it, but the other app companies don't apply. So, again, it's market. For me, it's market forces and how the present suppliers respond to the new guys that are coming in.
Okay, thank you, Claire Adamson, please.
Taking us back a wee bit to an earlier part of the discussion where we were talking about the knowledge test. Given that we are also talking about apps and we have satellite navigation systems in most cars and smartphones now, is the knowledge test still fit for purpose?
Mr. McIntosh, please.
Absolutely, it serves a purpose, yes. I mean, the taxi drivers are hired on an instant basis at the taxi stands. Very often they are picking up people who have come from abroad who don't know where they're going or how to get there. And the taxi driver needs to instantly be able to plot the journey, mostly in his head. I'm sure you're aware of the situation in London where it takes anything up to 2 years to learn the geographical knowledge of London. It's not quite as bad in Edinburgh and perhaps Aberdeen and other places like Glasgow, but nonetheless, it serves a very useful purpose, because if the drivers don't have the knowledge for that instant hire, it gets in the door there and then, then where are we sitting pressing buttons and satellite navigation? It definitely is required.
Mr. Woodburn?
thank you for that. Controversial one for me to respond on, and I think at the end of the day, there is a need for a knowledge test in terms of the Hackney trade. In terms of the private hire trade, do I think a knowledge test is a bad thing or a form of training to be done for private hire drivers? Anything that raises the standard of drivers has to be a good thing. And again, it might be controversial, might not be to other people within the private hire sector, but I don't see training of drivers as why that should be a negative thing. My concerns are my earlier concerns that, you know, if the same testing were in terms of knowledge and street tests were applied to private hire drivers, would that be necessary? I would say no, it wouldn't be necessary to go to that level. Why? Because, as Bill's already stated, a public hire driver, a taxi, is a there and then hire in a public place, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. So without going into the current legislation and boring you to tears, that would be my stance on it.
Mr. McVay.
Definitely, yes. Again, what Kevin just said, it installs a commitment and a standard for the people coming into the trade. We have to have something like that. You know, it's not going to be a casual trade. We have to have knowledge and routes, the whole thing. And we teach them at our taxi school all different types of things, situations that they'll get involved in, to make it more casual. I don't know. I'm sure everybody getting into taxis in Edinburgh would start complaining if people didn't know where they were going, or they had to turn the sat nav on to find out. And we do have instances where guys have followed the sat nav. Maybe new briefs have come in, and we have to sit them down and go over it again because they went round the bypass and it's an extra £5 or £6 on the fare. They have to have knowledge, and that's a key part of our service.
Thank you.
Claire?
No, fine with that.
Thank you. Willie Coffey, please.
Just on that last point there, I'd like to share with the committee an unfortunate experience I had when I came to Edinburgh a couple of years ago.
One.
There always one, aye. A particular taxi driver hadn't a clue how to get to Easter Road Stadium. I mean, it's quite a big structure, you know, it's been there for quite a while. You know, and he charged me £20 for the pleasure of driving around in circles and still couldn't find it.
Did I jump in? Is that black taxi?
I can't remember.
You can't remember?
Anyway, let's not deal with Willie's stadium problems, Willie.
I wanted to tease out again, convener, the idea of protection of the public, and particularly connecting it with the issue that John Wilson raised, if somehow unlicensed taxis and drivers appeared on the scene. What do we do under those circumstances? Do we need to tighten the legislation, or is it improving public awareness? So if a car turns up at 2 a.m, I don't imagine people will be looking out the window or whatever going, oh, there's no plate on that car, I'm not getting in it. What should we do to advise the public about their rights and obligations and so on to protect them? And back to the app, this whole app that we've been talking about all morning, can the apps somehow not signal to the customer the car that's coming to get you is licensed and your driver is Mr. or Mrs. X? And it does do that, does it?
Mr. McIntosh, do you want to go first on that, please?
You've asked a very difficult question. How do you educate the public? We've been trying to do that since 1982, and the message still hasn't got across. I mean, there are so many people in the cities at weekends who will jump into anything that's got four wheels. As long as they get home, that's their main objective, and that's their only objective. They don't take the opportunity to look and see if it's got a license number and it's, or if it says pre-booked tyres only, or it's a taxi. Just get me home quickly. And I really don't know how to answer that question. It would take a major, major media campaign to achieve what you're looking for.
Mr. Woodburn?
Totally agree with Bill. Totally agree with Bill. I think if you go into any city centre on a Saturday night, you will find a multitude of different vehicles picking people up left, right and centre, whether they be licensed, whether they be unlicensed. Let's not pretend that Uber coming into the marketplace is the start of potentially unlicensed vehicles going out on a Saturday night applying for hire. It happens in every city across the country every Saturday night in life already. You also have situations where you have, again, you know, public hires, if you like, taxis, and you have private hire operators, unscrupulous private hire operators, who will apply for hire on a Saturday night. Let's not kid ourselves on that it doesn't go on. It goes on every single Saturday night in life. The companies involved, the private hire companies, can do their best to tell the drivers, you must not do this, you must not do that. But at the end of the day, once they're out there driving around the streets, it's virtually unenforceable, and that's the problem. And I think it has to come back to what you rightly said, Mr. Coffey, is educating the public. And how you do that, good luck. But at the end of the day, I think that's really the only answer. And starting with the younger ones and working your way up to the dinosaurs like us and getting to us eventually is really where it has to start. It's educating the public, particularly... And it does happen, and it has happened, and we all know instances of it. You know, particularly young females out at the weekend, who, you know, at the end of the day, they are probably the most vulnerable. I'm not saying that, you know, young guys aren't vulnerable, but at the end of the day, you know, young females are probably the most vulnerable of all. And, you know, to be in situations where, you know, they jump into what they think is a private hire car, or what they think is a taxi, or, you know, and we have to look at things like better signage, more appropriate signage. You know, you've touched on the apps. It may well be that when a response is sent via an app, that an actual picture of the driver can be sent with his badge. There are all sorts of technical innovations that can be added into apps that make it more public safety orientated. And I'm delighted that, you know, we're sitting here answering questions about public safety, because ultimately that's surely what all of the legislation is about. You know, regardless of what the trade might think, it's surely about public safety. And that's my concern with all of these things over the years, is that we lose track of why we're doing what we're actually doing.
Mr. McVay, please.
Was your question about members of the public jumping into unlicensed vehicles and unlicensed drivers? Or
yeah, how do we protect them from...
Do you think that happens every week?
It used to happen a lot, Les. I don't know. It
certainly
answer.
Happens in my neck of the woods on a regular basis, I have to say.
Well, I mean, again, Edinburgh. I deal with the complaints that come into CityCabs, and I can't remember the last time I had a complaint with somebody that got into it. I do recognise the fact that it is frustrating for us, as you saw my response when you mentioned the Easter Road. I was quite keen to get some information off you.
But he'll give you it afterwards.
So, I mean, it is frustrating for us as a company when somebody comes in and gives us a complaint and they can't provide a number or a plate number or a registration. But what we have in our system is, even if, and again, it's a beneficial to Police Scotland, even if it's just a pick-up point, they could pick up at Omni Centre to go to Wester Hills, we have that information, and then we can find out the driver. You know, we have that exact details for that, and it can tell them the route he took, it can tell how much he charged for it. We all have that in our system. So it's not, we don't necessarily need the plate number or the rest of it. As far as people, there have been isolated incidents that rogue drivers get in their vehicles and approach people in George Street at 2 or 3 in the morning. But I don't think it's a big factor. I think it's isolated, and I'd hate to say once a year or whatever it is. But again, it's the ones that make the press for obvious reasons. We had one, a private hire guy who had lost his license but still had his badge, and that was a few years ago now though. But I mean, and he went back to, and the police were looking for him for a rather unsavoury incident. Colin Kerr, MSP, he runs a campaign every Christmas. Unfortunately, he runs it too late. He runs it in the week after all the Christmas parties are gone, promoting people to get into taxis, private hire, and use us. And we actively encourage them to use our app, because it is a great thing, especially for a female on her own. She can stay where she is, she can stay safe, she can book the taxi herself, and then she can track the taxi. And it gives her the name, the registration of the driver, the call sign on the driver, and she can see it coming along the road, and she can actually physically watch it on the screen. And that's what we try and promote at Christmas and New Year time. Unfortunately, we've asked Colin next year to try and get it the week before the office parties instead of the week after the office parties.
I'm sure he'll read the official report and get on to that, Mr. McVay.
You highlight that and green.
Willie.
Hi, thanks, Camille. Just one last question, please, again on public safety.
If a taxi turns up and a customer is unhappy about the circumstances, are they, and to use your, to the benefit of your own knowledge and experience, is the customer at liberty at that point to reject the transaction or the contract, if you like? At what point does the contract become valid?
Mr. McVay.
So just so that the public can be aware that if they're not happy with a car or a driver, they can reject it when it arrives.
Anything they're not happy with, whatever whatever reason that they have, they can reject the car, the driver, at any time.
When's the contract complete, when you've made the journey?
The contract's made after the journey's complete, either for the driver. If the driver fails to complete it for any reason, if it breaks down, then he cannot charge.
Could you find where he was going?
Yeah, sorry?
Or he couldn't find where he was going?
Yeah, well, again, you've had some bad experiences, haven't you? it's very much in the customer's favour. The customer can halt the transaction at any time for whatever reason.
So the taxi driver can't say to a person, oh, you're rejecting the booking, you still owe me the money?
Yeah, I mean, tomorrow I'm going down to Paton's and I hope to be the first taxi driver in Edinburgh that puts CCTV in the taxis. And we've tried for this for about maybe 5, 6, 7 years and we've always failed at the last hurdle. But now, hopefully tomorrow, I've got the variation of licence, I'm the data controller, and it's all meets the requirements of the Edinburgh City Council. So we'll have a taxi, we'll have a CCTV unit in the back of forward-facing camera on the driver and the camera in the back for the customers.
Mr. Woodburn.
Yes, I agree with Les's answer on that. You know, the contract is cancelable, if you like, at any point. You know, prior to the journey commencing, there is a cancellation charge within the tariff sheet that you can be levied with a cancellation charge and so on and so forth. So there are elements in there, if you like, to treat it as a proper contract where you can charge a cancellation fee and whatnot. But the circumstances would be unique and individual, probably to each and every journey that's out there. So I think it's probably impossible to have a policy in place, whether it be a company policy or a legislative policy, that's going to cover every possible eventuality, and I think what's already in place services it pretty well.
Mr. McIntosh, please.
Well, I don't have a lot to add to what's already been said, except in my opinion, the public, when they hire a taxi, whether it be the street or through a dispatch company, they have the right to terminate that, to hire it. At any time, it then becomes a civil matter between them and the driver concerned. And I don't know of any driver who's going to pursue the loss of a fare through the courts. As far as I'm concerned, they can terminate at any time if they've got good cause.
Thank you. Cameron Buchanan, please.
Thank you. I declare I have a contract with Edinburgh City Private Hire. The problem that I've had sometimes is their lack of knowledge of English. Do you give them either an English test as well as a security test? Yes, it is.
Okay, I just wanted to clarify that was a hypothetical question.
Oh, strange realms, which is out of the scope completely and utterly, I think. You can have that conversation with the gentleman afterwards.
Well, I haven't. Can I?
If it's another question on another matter, yes.
Do you think the bill that we're proposing has major flaws or goes far enough, the one that we're proposing? Do you think it has major flaws and does it go far enough?
Briefly, gentlemen, starting with Mr. McVay.
I think it probably goes far enough. I think, you know, if we have, best guidance, best practice guidance that the councils work within. And again, you cannot legislate for every area, whether it's urban, rural or city. It has to be flexible. It has to be flexible for every area. I mean, the guy that's operating in Pitlochry isn't necessarily doing the same sort of requirement as the people in Edinburgh. So it is a difficult one to legislate for every single taxi or private hire service in Scotland. It has to be flexible. Regulation and restriction is good, but only if the taxi firms don't try and hide behind that regulation and restriction. If they come up and meet the requirements of the public and obviously meet competition, that's when regulation and restriction, it maintains a standard. But it's a very difficult one to bring in laws to legislate against every single enterprise, taxi or private hire business in Scotland. I don't.
Mr. Woodburn, please.
In terms of the three areas of the bill that are relevant to this trade, without knowing the politics behind those being in the bill, not that I'm suggesting there are any politics behind them, but if there were to be any, and I didn't know the reasoning behind those, it's a very difficult question to answer whether it goes far enough, because at the end of the day, the 3 points that are in the bill, do they go far enough for those 3 points? They probably do, yes. Should there be some form of training? Yes. I would like to drill down into the specifics of that, as I would like to build down into the specifics of the capping of licences, the numerical capping of licences, and as to, you know, what formula will be used in each individual authority as to how they achieve that. I'd like to drill into that further. But is it a bad thing that there is potential capping allowable? No, I don't think it is. So, no, I would say I'm happy enough with the three things that are on the bill. Could it go further? Could more things be added? Probably yes. But again, without getting into the politics of it all and knowing the motivation behind those three things, it would be very difficult to add anything more to it.
Mr. McIntosh, please.
Well, I stated earlier we have concerns in regard to the over-provision clause mainly because there is no measurement that I am aware of that councils can use to measure whether there are an appropriate number of private hire cars or not, and that this will be challenged by some sharp lawyers, I have no doubt, and that the councils will end up in court on a regular basis by refusing. There then is a cost factor to that, which ends up on the back of the cab in the private hire industry, and that's our concerns. It's by no means closed. We did suggest a controversial solution to the government. Obviously, they didn't find much favour with it, but the proposal we had was that anyone applying for a licence, then the bonus, or let's say the burden of proof, whether there's an unmet demand or an overprovision or underprovision, should rest with the applicant and not with the government, or the local authority, rather.
Okay. John Wilson, please.
Thank you. Just a quick one on that unmet demand. Mr. McVay intimated earlier that Edinburgh City Council do a survey every 3 years. Mr. McIntosh, do you know of any other authority that does a survey in terms of unmet demand?
A lot of the local authorities carry out their own surveys. How they do that, I really don't have any idea. But the only other place that I'm aware of who carry out surveys on a regular basis are maybe Dundee and, to a lesser extent, Stirling. I'm not saying that others don't do it, but it's a very costly exercise. So,
right, thank you very much indeed, Mr.
Thank
Mendoza.
You. Finally, gentlemen, in terms of the current legislation and the proposed legislation, do you think there is enough in that dealing with disability access issues? Mr. Woodburn, first of all, please.
Quite a difficult one for me to delve into too deeply. The way the current legislation sits in terms of disabilities is that because private hire has to be pre-booked, you'll find that there is a dearth of wheelchair-accessible vehicles within the private hire sector, other than the ones that are currently used for local authority school hires, as an example. So in private hire terms, it's extremely difficult for me to really get into detail and comment too much on the disability part, because there really isn't a lot of manoeuvrability within the private hire sector on that. So probably better the two taxi guys responding to that.
Mr. McIntosh, please.
There is a major difficulty in terms of access because there are so many differing disabilities. It's not just a case that people are in wheelchairs that are well catered for now in major cities like Edinburgh, Glasgow. There are plenty of wheelchair accessible vehicles, but there are many other disabilities affecting people, and the wheelchair accessible vehicle is not appropriate for their needs. As I think I've said in my letter to this particular committee, that the cost of the vehicles are prohibitive as it stands, If we were to supply a vehicle that meets every disability, or to try and supply a vehicle that meets every disability, then the cost would be, go to an extent where nobody could afford to buy it and nobody could afford to hire it anyway. So there is a lot of difficulty still to be overcome and understood in that regard.
Mr. McVay, please.
I think Edinburgh were the first city in Britain to supply a fully wheelchair accessible fleet back in the mid 80s, I think it was. And every public hire vehicle on the road has a wheelchair facility. Again, for Edinburgh, it's fine, but for rural areas, and as Bill said, the cost of putting a wheelchair accessible vehicle on for a rural area that might never do a wheelchair or might do one a month or whatever it is, again, it has to be driven by how much, you know, the economics of it all. So I don't know if for a bill to put something in it. But I know Edinburgh and Glasgow think it's the same. Glasgow not wheelchair. Glasgow's the same. I don't know what it's like in Aberdeen. Obviously, it's saloon cars in Aberdeen. So there you'd have to legislate for a different situation regarding the ratio of wheelchair-accessible cars to saloon cars. In Edinburgh, all the hacks or the public cars are wheelchair-accessible.
Okay, thank you very much, gentlemen. I'll suspend for probably until 5:00, because I think you might have some conversations with members to have about Easter Road and various other things. So I'll suspend until 5 to 12. Thank you. Thank you. We now move on to our third and final panel of witnesses for today. I'd like to welcome Mrs. Audrey Watson, Managing Solicitor of West Lothian Council, and welcome back. You were here a few weeks ago. Douglas Campbell, Assistant Managing Solicitor for Licensing from Renfrewshire Council, and Tom Berney, Chair of the Scottish Older Persons Assembly. Would any of you like to make any opening remarks? Mr. Campbell?
Thank you, Convener. I would simply just like to say thank you for the opportunity to come along to address the Board on behalf of Renfrewshire Council. By way of introduction, but perhaps also to say that we are the authority that covers Glasgow Airport. We, for our part, have a number of limitations in relation to taxis and a fairly high number of private hire cars as well. We also do have a taxi knowledge test, and we have a wheelchair accessible policy, if that's helpful to members.
Okay. Mr. Berney, do you?
Just to explain, in case people don't know, that the Scottish Older People's Assembly is a body that represents all of the major voluntary organisations for older people in Scotland. And what we do is we hold an annual assembly, but we also go around the country inviting older people to tell us what they think is important, and we then lobby government on those issues. I have to confess we haven't done too much in that in taxis at the moment, but maybe say that later. Okay.
Thank you. Mrs. Watson.
I'd just like to say thank you for inviting me back. I'm happy to answer any questions on West Lothian's submission. We're near an urban area, not quite an urban area. We have our semi-rural area, so happy to answer any questions.
Thank you for that. Can I start off by asking you what you consider to be the advantages and the disadvantages of the current two-tier licensing system? Can you maybe include within your answer whether you think there are benefits for service users with additional needs? Mr. Berney, first of all, do you have an opinion on that?
Well, a little bit different for us, of course, because what we are concerned about, particularly when we ask old people, is the service that they're receiving from taxis, and they're more concerned, really, about that rather than the structure of how they're organised. But I do have comments on that. If I may say so, listening this morning to Dr. Cooper and Mr. Woodburn, was it, and talking about the kind of what looked to me like a sort of free market, free-for-all for hiring cars, seemed to me quite scary, because what we're talking about, as we touched on earlier, was that we're putting people, in our case older people, vulnerable people, into potentially hazardous situations. And so, in principle, we are naturally in favour of licensing and regulation, and that all kind of people should be trained. A wee anecdote, maybe, if I could say that. I was in London once in a hotel, and I asked them to get me a taxi, and they got me a minicab. And asked the minicab driver to take me to the Department of Trade and Industry. He didn't know where it was, so I said, Victoria Street. And he didn't know where it was. And I said, well, it's near Westminster Abbey. And he didn't know where it was. And when you're in that situation, you're in a driver who hasn't a clue, you realise just how vulnerable you are. And so I think it is important. When you talked about how important is the knowledge testing, I think it is very important indeed, because people want to have the confidence that the driver at least knows where they're going. Now, the kind of things that we've been concerned about is really that a lot of people using taxis and hire cars, it's a kind of step into the dark, because they're not too sure what the rights are and what they can reasonably expect from the driver by way of a service. So what we're worried about is that a thoughtfulness that drivers should take note of the passenger's condition, that they should, if you like, should treat the older people as if it was their own mother or their own father. And we're concerned about the relationship between the driver and his or her performance. And it seems to me that the only way that can be achieved is by having regulation testing and licensing drivers and so on. Little things make a difference, like when someone gets their cab, a lot of older people might have arthritis, so they've just been picked up from a hospital and painful. Drivers will sometimes drive over speed bumps and stuff like that, which is quite painful for them. So consideration for the passengers. Some drivers we find now, I'm going to give you a list of problems that we've...
Well, I think
We'll get a list of problems as we come through the questions. If we could stick to answering the specific questions, you will get an opportunity, Mr. Berney, to go through all of the other things too.
Okay, specific question on what then?
The specific question was the two-tier licences system itself and how that impacts on the service users with additional needs. And I think you've given me a fairly lengthy answer there. So we'll come back to you, Mr. Berney. Let me hear from Mr. Campbell.
Thank you, Convener. I suppose the principal advantage in making the matter or the system one tier is that there won't be an issue of illegal hires by private hires because everyone will be able to apply for hire. But I do have concerns in terms of the disadvantages it could bring in terms of, in Renfrewshire, for instance, we have a wheelchair accessible vehicle policy for taxis, and as far as private hire cars are concerned, they can be saloon cars, estate cars or hatchbacks, or they may be bigger vehicles, may be MPVs, in which case we would ask them to be wheelchair accessible, and obviously that would mean that operators may wish to carry more passengers in those scenarios. But we do have a separate set of conditions, not just in wheelchair accessibility, but you know, in a number of areas, but principally wheelchair accessibility in relation to taxis. And I would have concerns if that distinction were to be removed, then who runs the private hire cars and who runs the saloon cars and who runs the wheelchair accessible vehicles, because obviously one is cheaper than the other, and having a taxi accessibility policy for wheelchairs means that we will have sufficient numbers of wheelchairs to serve the travelling public, in particular disabled people that need them.
Thank you. Mrs. Watson, please.
Yes, I would echo what Mr. Campbell has said. Certainly in West Lothian, the policies which the council has put into place in the last few years has meant that taxis and private hire cars complement each other. If you want a specialist vehicle that can carry a heavy wheelchair, for example, you can book one of our Type 2 private hire cars. And if you want a taxi, then as from the end of this month, you'll be able to know whether you can access that taxi, whether you can hail one in the street, or whether you can queue up at a taxi ramp, because you'll know what the standard is. Prior to that, we found that a lot of vehicles, bigger vehicles, were being used by the private hire trade were eminently suitable as wheelchair accessible and disabled accessible vehicles, but there was nothing to compel the operators of these vehicles to put in the necessary requirements to allow disabled people to access them easily.
And in terms of some of the points that Mr. Berney has touched upon, in terms of knowledge tests and all of the other things, you as licensing authorities at this moment in time do anything in terms of trying to ensure that taxi or private hire car drivers take into account the needs of the folks who are using their service, or do you think that's a matter for them as individual operators or companies? Mrs. Watson, please.
I feel quite strongly about that. I feel that we're in a world which is quite regulated. And when I was here the last time, we were talking about liquor licensing. Almost everyone in the liquor licensing area needs to pass a test. I think everyone in the hire car sphere should have a certain level of expertise. As in our area, most of these people are self-employed, and so there's no employer going to come along and say that they need to set a particular test. So I think that the government should set a standard. And we were one of two councils who worked with the Scottish Government in relation to looking at testing training for hire car drivers. We worked with People First, and they set up a number of modules covering customer service, accessibility, pricing, the legalities, and that was certainly very well received. And we would like to put that in place, but we would like the government to say that it should be put in place for all areas.
Mr. Campbell, please.
Thank you, Convener. In terms of assisting the travelling public in general terms, we, in relation to taxis, particularly have a condition that reasonable assistance should be given to passengers with luggage. But turning to the The point about knowledge test, particularly, we also have a knowledge test, and I agree with Mrs. Watson in terms of that's something that I think should be encouraged. Obviously, it's a resource implication for local authorities in terms of these tests have to be invigilated.
Yes, for Hackney and for private hire as well.
No, sorry, only for taxis. Okay. Only for taxis. But if the provision were to come in, obviously, it would give authorities the discretion to introduce such a policy. In relation to that, obviously the numbers would be bigger for private hire cars. We for instance, think we've got 214 taxis, which is our numbers limit. Private hire cars, we've got more than three times that, I think almost four times that. So it's obviously, it means that would have to be accommodated. Knowledge tests themselves differ throughout the country, but Section 13 of the current legislation is geared towards topography and knowledge of the streets in the area, plus such other matters as the board, as the council thinks appropriate. Accept what Mrs. Watson has also said in relation to the people first training. I think there probably are difficulties in having that as a mandatory system at the moment, given the current provision, if it's not taken up voluntarily. I think the difficulty perhaps with extending the training, making it much wider, is although the legislation says it can cover currently such other matters as the council thinks appropriate, whether that would be enough to include matters such as child protection and so forth may be a moot point.
Okay, Mr. Berney.
I think we would prefer that the private hires were also licensed and had to do knowledge testing and that type of thing. But I think, to me, listening to it today, there were comments like how regulations vary between around the country. Arrangements vary between different companies in the same area. And what people want, I would say from our point of view, is people want clarity about what they're getting into when they hire a car, whether it's a taxi or a hired car. And what we would recommend is that we have some kind of taxi passengers charter where we could then tell people, somebody, I think it was Mr. Woodburn at the end, said the important thing was to educate the public about the use of private car, of hired cars one way or the other. And I think it should be important that public should know, one thing to have regulations, but the public should know what the regulations are and what the regulations entitle them to, and both in terms of the type of price they're going to pay, the kind of journeys they can make, and also the kind of service they can expect from drivers. So I would like to see us have something where, rather than just us talking about the detail of the regulation and how it's going to work between the two different sectors, I'd like to see us publishing guidance to drivers and the public about the type of training. We had talk, for example, with drivers do training on disability. They have modules on disability, they have modules and other things. Well, I didn't know that. And I think the public should know that, and they should know that if the driver has been trained and that kind of thing, the public should know what type of training they've had and what kind of service and understanding they ought to have. Because too often, the reports that we get are that, I'm not saying all taxi drivers are bad by any means, most are very good. But you get the odd cases where drivers just don't seem to accept that they do have some kind of responsibility to the passenger. So I would like to see, maybe it could be done by having long press adverts about this is the charter between the hire company and the passenger, what you're entitled to. Maybe little notices in doctors' waiting rooms, in community centres, trying to get people in the idea that the public understand how the licensing process works.
Do you think the public are actually interested in how the licensing process works?
No, I was going to say, they want to know not so much the licensing process, how it works, but what the implications of the licensing process are in terms of what they're entitled to, which cars they can use, how much they can be charged, and what type of service the driver should provide for them. Which kind of cars they can have, which will have ramps to bring car.
I'm going to stop you, Mr. Burney, and I'm going to play devil's advocate, because I always say, and probably my fellow committee members are bored of me saying this, sometimes we cannot legislate for common sense, and we can create lots and lots of different things. The charter that you're talking about, all of this advertising, and the booklets that you've talked about, all of that would have to be covered by the amount of fees that are charged to the trade itself. And then again, that would obviously reflect back on the public, because they would have to pay for that and the fares that they are paying. Do you actually think that to do what you're suggesting would be welcomed by the public who are likely to be charged for what you're suggesting?
Yes, because when Mr. Woodburn talked about a free market and the market will decide and people have a choice, well, you don't have a choice unless you've got an informed choice. And we'd like to know what actually you're booking, which one company is different from another. Now, you have some companies, for example, that advertise that they're women-friendly and because they're going to take particular concern over women. Well, why not also have companies saying that they're also age-friendly and they're going to take particular concern for older people? That type of thing.
That's up to individual companies, and they will gain or not gain from what they do in terms of that. And that's, again, a market scenario.
Depends on your view of what government should do, doesn't it? Now, if you think that, well, okay, we're going to have a public service and that's what taxes come down to in the end, run surely on the basis of what individual companies decide to do, that's one thing. But I do believe that there should be government oversight on the type of, as part of the licensing arrangements, about the kind of service and the kind of commitment that the companies are going to give to vulnerable groups.
Okay, thank you. John Wilson, please.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning. It's just that, Mr. Campbell, you gave a number, and I believe it was 214 taxis, and that's the upper limit. That's your maximum number of taxis. But you said there's about three times as many as private hire cars. Have you an upper limit?
No, sorry. There are more than three times as many private hire cars because we don't have an upper limit. I would take the view that we can't have an upper limit at the present time.
Can I ask why the view of the authority is that you can't have an upper limit on private hire cars, but you can have an upper limit in terms of the number of taxis?
Section 10 of the 1982 Act specifically allows authorities to refuse an application for a licence for a taxi licence where there is no significant unmet demand for those services for taxis in the area. There is no provision, so effectively one provision is made explicitly, and that provision is not replicated in the Act for private hire cars.
But the I'm trying to get the issue of why you feel there is an upper limit can be applied to taxis, but there is no upper limit for private hire cars. When we are currently see the distinction between a taxi and the operation of a private hire car, the lines being blurred. Now, I was saying this earlier to a couple of colleagues. I remember I was on a licensing board in 1980, and I vaguely remember part of the reason for the change in the legislation in 1982 was around the issue of the number of taxis that was felt. There was adequate number of taxis in local authorities, but by introducing private hire cars could be used to help service peak time demand for cars for hire. Now, if you're saying you have, as an authority, you have maximum number in terms of 214 taxis, but no distinction in terms of private hire cars, how do you make that distinction between how a private hire car operates and a taxi operates?
Thank you for the question. I think perhaps I could just explain some of the context. We do have a numbers limitation in respect of taxis. The view we have taken is that of the legislation, I think that is the view of our authorities as well, is that because the provision is explicit for one and not the other, then it wouldn't be competent for us to introduce a process at the moment. Obviously, that would change if the over-provision provision in the new bill was to be enacted. But what happens is that any decision on that has to be evidence-based. Because we have that power in relation to taxis, we get an external survey produced from time to time. And that's boosted by stance observations by the civic enforcement officer that we have on a voluntary basis. So it's evidence-based. Because there is no provisional legislation at the present time, it's not something that we've sought. And I would have to add at considerable cost to get that evidence to inform such a policy. The only other things I'd perhaps add in relation to your question is that in terms of peak time demand, although there obviously is a bottleneck and an issue at peak time demand, the case law under the 1982 Act seems to say that, yeah, there will be periods when the demand does reach a peak. peak, and perhaps there will be an element of waiting time at ranks, but the guiding principles understands that it's more of a general demand by the public for services.
I understand that, Mr. Campbell, and I'm picking your authority in particular because of the distinction that you've made in terms of taxis versus private hire cars. Could you indicate how often the surveys are carried out by your authority and whether or not there's been any account taken of the increased demand that may have arisen because of the increased number of passengers arriving at Glasgow Airport, particularly given that Renfrewshire Council has the authority responsible for taxi ranks at Glasgow Airport, and was there any indication of unmet demand or demand peaks during the time of the Commonwealth Games and other events such as that, that the local authority could have taken account of to increase the number of taxi licences?
Mr. Campbell.
In terms of how often, I can say that our last policy in relation to numbers, the last update that was done externally, I think it was in 2010, there are periodic inspections by the Civic Government Enforcement Officers. I can't remember exactly. I know there have been, from time to time, stance observations done. Not sure that the Commonwealth Games in particular, there was an examination of that. But we do have to work within general demand as well, because there will be times of peak business, and obviously the private hire cars and otherwise can obviously service the market as well. Just to explain, though, how the process works, if we get a report from an external organisation into numbers, that doesn't bar somebody from making an application for a taxi licence, despite the fact we may have reached our numbers threshold. What happens is a person's entitled to an application in, and that will be considered by our regulatory functions board, which effectively is our civic licensing committee.
Just for clarification, Mr. Campbell, if you've reached your maximum number of operational taxis in Renfrewshire and somebody makes an application, then that application, based on the you've reached your maximum number, will be rejected?
No, we can't do that. There's case law, in particular case law in the mid-noughties, if I can put it in those terms, where there's a residual discretion. Because we have a policy, doesn't mean that we can rigidly adhere to that policy. We have to be able to listen to people and admit of exceptions. Now, I'm not able to perhaps project what might be a successful act before the board, but we do have to put an application before board. It will be flagged as an issue to the person applying that we have reached our threshold, and that therefore there's a risk that their application may not find favour with the board, but that is ultimately a matter for the councillors, and it's not a matter for me as an officer to bounce an application.
Can I take you back a little bit? Because you said that in terms of private hire car, that under Section 10 of the 1982 Act, that you couldn't put a cap on numbers. In your opinion, if any local authority was to put a cap on, at this moment, with the current legislation, on private hire cars, would they be in breach of the 1982 Act?
They wouldn't be explicitly in breach of it. I suppose where I'm coming from is there's a specific provision about taxis that hasn't been replicated for private hire cars. What a court would make of that, I'm not sure the point has been taken.
How many local authorities are you aware of? And I know you probably won't be able to answer, but are there many local authorities that you're aware of who have a cap in private hire?
I wasn't aware there were any, but there may be.
Okay. Mrs. Watson, in terms of Section 10 of the 1982 Act, what's your interpretation of that in terms of private hire car caps?
Yes, I agree with Mr. Campbell. I've always thought that no one had a limit, and I certainly would think that if you did have a limit under the current legislation, that would be challengeable on appeal.
Okay, thank you very much. John, sorry, do you want to come back?
Convener, it was just I'm trying to still understand Mr. Campbell's licensing committee remit. If you have reached your cap and somebody makes an application, then the committee can then adjust their thinking on that and grant a taxi license, which then means that your limit would then go up, rather than 214, would go up to 215 if the committee agreed to grant that license. So on the basis of that, then is there really a cap there?
Yes, the limit would still be 214, but in the situation you're describing, which isn't a situation that we have at the moment. But if that situation arose, the limit in terms of the policy would be at 214, but effectively, de facto, we would have made an exception to it, which would take the actual number of licences issued to 215. But the point I'm trying to make is that in the application process, we can have a policy, but somebody can still come in. And the wording of the legislation is that we may refuse a licence where we consider there's significant unmet demand. It doesn't say we will, because we've found evidence there's, you know, there's no significant unmet demand.
Right. As I said, Convener, I'm just trying to get my head around the flexibility that exists for licensing committees to actually, if you've already set an upper limit.
I think the answer to that is that it's really up
to the licensing committee or board will set the limit. And then the licensing committee or board then will look at applications which may breach that limit.
Yeah, well, we have to look at applications and evidence in its own merits, and the board's got a discretion, and it can't fetter that discretion, and the courts are clear about that. But that's not to say that a good case might not merit an exception.
Cameron, you want to come in on this?
You mentioned significant unmet demand. That presumably something like West Lothian, if it was out with the reach of the centre of West Lothian, then that would constitute significant unmet demand, where there weren't enough if there was a case for it. Is that what you're meaning?
Yeah. No, I think the test is actually that we can refuse an application for a taxi licence where we are satisfied that there is no significant unmet demand.
Right.
So I apologise,
so
I haven't made that as clear as I might have.
Okay. Thank you. Alec Crowley, please.
Just in that same bit, I mean, it was mentioned, but I was asked both the local authority witnesses in terms of significant costs, in terms of determining what is provision and over-provision. So in terms of the types of surveys that you would do, do you see major cost implications in terms of trying to establish private hire? And also, it was mentioned by, I think, one of the last witnesses, that how would you measure that? How would you measure for private hire what was over-provision?
Let's start with Mrs. Watson this time, please.
Well, in 2009, West Lothian Council decided to do away with our limit on taxis. And the reason for that was twofold. One, we didn't think that there could possibly be unmet demand, say there was no unmet demand, when there were new private hire cars being licensed every day. The market must work, and these people must find work in order to remain licensed, and the numbers of private hire cars have gone up steadily through the last few decades. So that we thought that was a difficulty. The second one was that having a cap creates a black market for licences. License plates change hands on the basis of money. Now, given that the legislation provides that the licence comes to an end when someone dies, what we found in our area was that Mr A no longer wished to operate his taxi, so he leased it to Mr B, who perhaps provided a new vehicle. But when Mr A died, the licence came to an end, and we didn't think that was right.
Okay.
So we did away with the limit.
Mr Campbell.
In terms of costs, they're substantial, the costs, even for doing a taxi survey. And now that what's proposed for private hire cars, and I have to say, anything that gives discretion to local licensing authorities, I'd broadly welcome. But it's a different test, so I'm not sure whether that would mean basically doubling the costs of surveys if an authority was decided to go down the private hire route as well in terms of over-provision. I can't release any figures. I'm not aware of them anyway at the moment in relation to how much we spend, but I mean it would be a substantial sum on a single survey, even just for taxis. In terms of a private hire car measurement, it's perhaps more difficult than taxis because you can measure at ranks for taxis. For pre-booked cars, I'm not quite sure how you establish if there is over-provision, which itself, I think, in terms of the proposed legislation, requires an examination of demand as well. So you're looking at over-provision and demand as part of that. I also have some lack of understanding how it would work in practice. In terms of liquor licensing, there are clear licensing objectives that are sought to be achieved by the legislation, such as crime prevention, securing public safety, preventing public nuisance and health objectives that are sought to be achieved by that legislation. I'm not sure whether over-provision as a test as opposed to unmet demand necessarily sits well with taxis, where it would be harder to say there are too many cars available to take people home at the end of an evening.
Alec, do you want to come back in?
No, that's
I wonder, you know, we're talking about demand and all of the rest of it, and I think Mrs. Watson is describing an approach where you have your authority is letting the market decide. You're paying for surveys and all of the rest of it. And Mr. Campbell just mentioned surveying demand. Local authorities survey residents quite a lot in various ways, shapes or forms throughout the country. Would it be wise in those surveys of residents, whether that be citizens' panels or whatever, to survey the general public and see what they think about taxi and private hire car provision in their area? We'll start with Mr. Berney, please.
I think that's the point. That, of course, I come here with a different remit from others in that, you know, I'm not a local authority, I'm not a taxi owner, but we were looking at it from the point of view of the customer. And at the end of the day, the reason you're tidying up the regulations, presumably, is to make life better for customers, safer and better for the general public. And I don't think that you can really make things safer and better for the general public unless you tell them what you've done or what you've achieved from. And I think one of the things, little things I was asking for, I don't think I'm winning here, but one of the things I was asking for was that if we learn, for example, that drivers, in order to be licensed, have to have a disability training, discrimination training, health training, and so on, well, I think it'd be helpful that the public knew that. I also think that we should, it'd be interesting to know, for example, if taxi drivers have to have that type of particular training, but hire drivers don't have to have it, well, I would think that would be wrong. I think that anybody who's being paid to drive the public around ought to be properly qualified, and part of that qualification ought to be that they have had some training on how to deal with disabled people and all that kind of thing.
Mr. Berney, I know you've got views on all of these things, and we will get to them, yes. But the specific question was round about, do you think that local authorities should be asking the public in their area about demand, whether they think that provision of taxis and private hire car in their area is enough or not?
Well, sufficient. Yes, certainly, and if you want us to, we can organise, we are organising another series of meetings around the country, we can make that one of the issues we discuss with our people, and yeah, I think local authorities could organise that, yeah.
That would be extremely useful, yeah. And if you want to feed anything back, we'd be grateful. Mr. Campbell.
I think I can be brief, convener, for perhaps the first time today. I think, to answer your question bluntly, yes, I think it would be wise to survey the public, but the only thing, to put that in context, in terms of taxis at the moment, what we do is we have an external survey carried out from time to time, and it's really quite detailed and thorough, because ultimately this is all challengeable by court, you know, before the courts. So evidence tends to be produced to local authorities that is robust. But to answer your question, yes, I'm sure that would, I would imagine that would form part of it.
Mrs. Watson, please.
Yes, in our submission, convener, we mention a lot of the changes which the council in West Lothian brought in since 2009. The reason that happened was we did a survey in 2008. We got a very good response, over 40%, which I think for surveys is quite incredible. And the biggest response we got was on disability issues. And so West Lothian Council decided they would set up a consultative group with representatives of key stakeholders, and that's where our changes came from. The biggest fault was that the lack of disabled accessible vehicles. Some people found that they had a very, very good response from the local operators that they used, but the vast majority were saying there aren't enough vehicles. that are accessible to us. And it's not just about wheelchairs, it's about people who are hard of hearing, people who can't see properly, and people who need ramps and steps. And there needs to be drivers trained as well. And that's why we think it's important that, the government brings forward training for all drivers.
Thank you. And in terms of demand, what did your survey show in terms of demand, and did that lead to any policy changes, or were your policy changes already in place?
Well, our difficulty was that if what the survey was telling us loud and clear was there weren't enough accessible vehicles, then by having a policy which restricted the numbers of accessible vehicles from being licensed, it was a no-brainer, really. There had to, that limit of on taxis had to be, had to go. And what's happened in the last 5 years is there are, the taxi numbers have stayed at almost the same level, but the number of private hires have gone down. But the numbers of accessible vehicles have gone up.
Thank you very much. That's extremely useful. Willie Coffey, please.
Thanks very much, Convener. I wonder if I could come back to the protection of the public issue that I raised earlier and take the advice of particularly my local authority colleagues. It was in terms of one taxi driver moving from one authority to another, where a substantial number of complaints had been raised against the person in the one authority, which were not known in the other authority. How can we improve that situation so that we can somehow improve or ensure protection of the public?
Mr. Campbell, please.
Yes, thank you. I know that in our application forms we ask if they've applied to other authorities, and that's one aspect of it. Obviously, all applications are sent to Police Scotland, who will comment, and that can include convictions, and it can include non-conviction conduct as well. That hasn't gone that far. Certainly, I appreciate the point you're making. It may be that it depends on the particular strength of the information available to the police as well, and ultimately the presentation that's put before the board. There are always going to be differences in approach by a board of elected members, because they have a discretion that they're entrusted with under legislation. But I take the point, and it's certainly a concern that local authorities, I think, in fairness, have. But we do ask, have you applied to another authority? And we also take into account information from the police. Just one of the points that was made earlier in relation to this, the board wouldn't set it aside. The police letter, it really becomes a matter as to how much weight gets given to certain information that's before the board when they exercise their discretion.
The person is intent on concealing and lying about his or her personal circumstances. How are you going to find out in the other authorities? I don't mean your two authorities particularly.
Well, I can only really speak
for... Are you entitled to... Is one authority entitled to pass on to another authority case examples where substantial complaints have been raised about a taxi driver? Are you not permitted to do that?
I'm not absolutely certain about that, but what I would say is that the application forms themselves that ask that question are actually passed on to Police Scotland. And they do sometimes raise this person has applied to Glasgow for a licence and been refused. That does happen.
Mrs. Watson?
Yeah, our applications say the same thing, but thinking through that, that probably works fine when it's a criminal matter, but where it's more a matter of low-level conduct, I'm not entirely sure that we would know that a driver had problems in other areas short of being suspended.
So an authority wouldn't necessarily pass that information on to neighbouring authorities that substantial complaints were raised about a particular driver? They wouldn't share that naturally, would they?
Not a data protection specialist, but I think I could see issues in relation to that.
Thank you.
Okay. One of the provisions is whether you welcome the removal of the contract exemption and what the practical implications of that may be. We've heard from some rural local authorities who are concerned about the withdrawal of the exemption because the additional cost might cause some hire car operators to withdraw from the market and because there may be an adverse impact on council procurement, for example, to take children to school or maybe older folks to lunch clubs or whatever. Mr. Berney, do you have a view on that?
No, I don't have a comment on that. No.
Okay, Mr. Campbell.
Thank you, Convener. I'm not involved in the procurement process, but I think it's part of the standard framework we have for those sort of contracts, that they do hold those sorts of licences anyway. So I don't know if there'd be an implication within Renfrewshire's respect of that. In broad terms, I do welcome the proposal to remove the exemption, as I've indicated in my consultation response, because I think it is an enforcement lacuna, where, you know, unless you actually monitor a driver, which you can't realistically do 24 hours a day, how do you say, if they say to you, well, I only take one hire a day, it's a potential loophole out of that. I accept Mrs. Watson has put in her response, you know, a couple of cases where there may be merit for an exemption that I haven't raised in mine. But I think where you have limousines that have less than or eight or fewer passenger seats, you know, effectively you could have limousine companies saying, well, you can't license us. Now, it's an issue potentially. I think there could be more control if the exemption were to be removed as proposed.
Mrs. Watson, please.
Yes. In my response, I say that it would be quite difficult to identify the top end, the chauffeur-driven vehicles. How would Police Scotland know that they were taking someone on a hire car journey? There would have to be some sort of signage, and I think that would have to differ from the private hire signage. And I think, as you've heard this morning, that a lot of steps have been taken to make sure the public know the difference between a taxi and a private hire car. Certainly in West Lothian and Edinburgh, there are door signs. I wouldn't imagine that top-end market would want that. But if they didn't get that, how would you identify how they became the top-end? What markers would you have? I'd simply worry about how that would all work in practice. I think in England they have plates that they put in the boot so that the passengers can check it's a licensed vehicle, but I don't see how enforcement officers could check that.
Okay, that's useful. Can I ask you if you share the Scottish Government's view that services that are run by community groups or charities which are not-for-profit continue to be exempt from the licensing regime? Mr. Berney?
Well, I do know some local communities have been running their own services, and it worries me a bit because I'd want to feel that the people who are doing that as well have had some testing before they're allowed to do it. Now, it's one thing for me to say I'll give somebody a lift occasionally, which I do, to the hospital or something, but if you're actually running it as a kind of service, as some cases are using it to cover up the lack of public transport, I think that becomes a worry, and so I would prefer that there was some sort of testing for people like that too.
So you think that community groups and charities should be, who are running services, should be included in the licensing regime?
I would think so, but possibly a less restrictive licensing regime. But it worries me that someone could just say, well, OK, I'm going to start replacing the local bus service. And it has. Down in Dumfries, I know a couple of people are doing that. It's a bit worrying because I'd want to think that we knew that they had at least a PSV licence or something like that, you know, they actually properly qualified for it.
Mr. Campbell? I suppose, coming at it from a regulation perspective, certainly I'd take the starting premise as the protection of the public. I can understand why the view would be held. It's not one I really feel I can express a particularly further view on. Mrs. Watson.
I would imagine that most of these hires would be covered by the provision of vulnerable groups legislation anyway, so that protects people from the drivers. In relation to vehicles, I'm simply not aware if there have been issues with vehicles which are not in a good state of repair taking people around, but we certainly wouldn't want to be involved in licensing if they didn't need to be licensed.
Okay. Do you have any concerns about the operation of the licensing regime which are not being addressed in the bill? Mrs. Watson, please.
In relation to the checking of previous convictions, if you're a taxi or private hire applicant, then you have none of your offences are spent unless they're offences which have been dealt with by ATPs, which are fixed penalties, which were introduced a few years ago. So I would like to see those not becoming spent for taxi and private hire car drivers, because we're seeing some fairly serious offences, such as violent disorder and drugs offences, being dealt with day and daily by ATPs, and these become spent, some of them immediately they're issued, and some of them within 3 months. And it means that if the police want to bring forward a person's entire history, they have to do what's called the two-stage test, and it becomes quite legalistic and I think not necessary for members of committees to have to deal with. They first have to say, there's something that isn't here that we want to tell you about, will you let us tell you about it? And then they need to tell you what it is if they passes that test. I think your whole record, if you want to transport the public, your whole record should be before the committee so they can decide whether you're a fit and proper person. And a lot of the ones I have concerns with are drugs offences.
Mr. Campbell.
I would echo those thoughts by Mrs. Watson. And I think the two-stage test, you know, becomes really quite complicated when you get into different regimes, because there are exclusions and exceptions in relation to drivers of private hire and taxi vehicles. And effectively can disable boards, as I understand the position, which is not straightforward in relation to looking at these sort of matters for drivers where they have become spent, either immediately, Mrs. Watson says, for fiscal warnings or after 3 months in the case of fiscal fines.
Thank you. Mr. Berney.
No.
Okay, thank you. We have heard today concerns about companies such as Uber and Halo entering the market. Do you have concerns on these fronts? And if so, what are they, Mr. Burney?
I'm sorry, I didn't catch the question. What was that?
In terms of Uber and Halo, the app companies that we were talking about earlier, do you have any concerns about them entering the market?
Yes, pretty much what I said at the beginning. I mean, I have an app on my own phone, like most people, and I can contact the local taxi company, and so that's relatively secure. But the worry was when I think Dr. Cooper was describing a possible explosion in the market, that if we have, you know, a few local companies, you can get to know the reputation of the local company. But if you have a complete free-for-all where there are dozens of companies and you're not sure who you're getting, that would worry me. So I think that he outlined in his paper the difficulty of keeping track of that type of thing. But I do think it's important that the government does take a grip, or the local authority takes a grip of it, and we make sure that anyone providing a service is a properly qualified driver. And I can see, as he said, the difficulties in doing that. You pick up your phone, you dial a number, you get a car, how do you know? That's what I was talking about earlier, that I think the important thing will be to let the public know what the situation is in relation to those kind of companies.
Mr. Campbell.
Thank you. Probably there's widespread concern about the points Dr. Cooper has made. And, certainly, I think he has raised considerable concerns. All I would perhaps add to those concerns, which Dr. Cooper is probably best placed to speak about in detail, given his knowledge of the technology and his own particular specialism, all I would add to that is that in civic government we have, I think, level 2 fines where offences are committed by people not having licences and so forth, whereas in liquor licensing it's level 5. Perhaps those levels of those penalties might be looked at some point.
And Mrs. Watson, please.
Yes, I was interested in what some of the earlier panel said about booking office licences. Certainly Mr. Campbell and I had a quick look at the legislation when we were sitting behind, and as far as we could see, what the evidence that you heard wasn't correct. You don't need to be licensed in your area to have a booking office. We certainly have one booking office which operates vehicles from the Falkirk area, which is licensed in West Lothian. There's nothing to say that the booking office and the vehicles and their drivers have to be connected. I know in the cities that most people work for one of the big companies, but that's simply not the case once you get out with the cities. Lots of people are self-employed. They might have their own vehicle. They might not be involved in any booking office at all. So as far as I can see, it may not be the case that Uber would need booking office licences, and that if someone had a booking office in England, for example, I don't think they would need a licence, and I think that should be tightened up immediately.
I think that's extremely useful. Yes, Mr. Berney?
Yeah. I think the situation he was describing, what worries me is that the way the internet works is that I could tomorrow open a website inviting people to put their name forward to be a driver, and they could then put their name on my website. Then someone contacts my website, it goes to one or other of the drivers. And it's that type of thing. How you regulate that and how you make sure that that type of thing is properly regulated rather than just having that kind of random system which the internet lends itself to, and that is the type of thing he was describing was difficult to control.
Okay. Mr. Campbell.
Thank you. I'll just come back in briefly. I'm not quite sure if I take Mrs. Watson's points entirely, and we did have a discussion and agree with what she has said. I'm not quite sure how it would work if the office was actually out with Scotland altogether, because it may be theoretically possible, although it does have to be relevant vehicles that are registered at booking offices, so I suppose whether they would be registered in England is perhaps less likely. But what we have in Renfrewshire is we have a condition locally, in addition to the mandatory conditions of booking office licence, which states that the holder of a taxi operator's licence shall not have installed in his taxi a two-way radio or similar device, the base of operation or control point of which is situated out with the boundary of Renfrewshire Council. So we have done that certainly at a local level, and we had done when the booking office regime came in. It may be that given there are other mandatory conditions for booking offices, that that's something that could be considered.
Okay. Mrs. Watson?
Yes, I would think that would be an excellent idea. My issue is we don't have a condition like that, because I'm not satisfied that that's a reasonable condition that would stand up to scrutiny by the appeal court. But if it was in the guidance, it certainly would. And I think things have moved on very quickly, and Dr. Cooper talked about that this morning, and I think the conditions and the mandatory conditions and the guidance all need to be scrutinised to make sure they're completely up to date.
Thank you very much. Any other questions, members? No. Can I thank you very much for your evidence today? And I suspend and we move into private session.